This is the podcast.
Welcome to 4Player Podcast.
Oh man, we're on it.
This is episode 451. I'm your host, Nick Henderson. To my right is Brad Simons.
Hey, I don't know what to do.
Nolan Hedstrom.
Hey, how's it going, everybody?
And Christopher Guthridge.
Hello, how's it going?
Doing well, thank you for asking.
I
was asking the people at home, I wasn't asking you.
Well, fuck you.
I got a we've been in the same room for like an hour or so now. I got an idea of how you are dealing.
We've been shooting the shit a little bit prior to the podcast. I was out last week. It's good to be back. I didn't get a chance to talk about some things that I wanted to talk about last week, so I'm glad to be here.
Get everything taken care of. It's finalized now.
Everything come out all right?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. I got it taken care of.
All right.
We're gonna do things a little bit differently this week, guys. We're experimenting a little bit with formatting. So this is gonna take a lot of people by surprise, but we're starting the podcast this week with the 4Player Minute.
Whoa! Shit! I can't handle it.
It's crazy.
It's so different.
What have y'all done to the audio? Look at the audio.
Oh my god.
Audio.
That's not good.
This is a blue wall. Oh, wait,
I think we need to wait for their eardrums to stop bleeding before we continue.
People in chat are going to be like, I missed the podcast. No.
People in chat are freaking the fuck out. Oh, God. They're unfollowing. Oh, God. We're gonna start with the 4Player Minute.
What's the 4Player Minute, Nick?
Well, I know a lot of people never get to this point in the podcast. So let me explain to you what the 4Player Minute is. We go around the room. We say something we're hyped about, our sweat, something we're worried about, our thank you of the week, and our fuck you of the week. We usually use it as a cool down on the podcast if we're doing it as a warm up. So Brad usually starts us off.
I'm gonna go. What's the 4Player? Oh wait, we already.
You already asked me that. Just go, Brad. And this doesn't necessarily have to be video game related. It can be anything. But you know, we like video games here, so.
Yeah, mine are probably. I mean, hey, I'm a video game kind of guy. My hype is for the new Captain Crush. No.
I like Chris Davis's comment. It's amazing that Sci-Fi stuck around for a full podcast.
Ooh, that's kind of cold-blooded.
I'm sorry. That was
cold-blooded. I like it, Chris Davis.
Everyone's riled up this week.
My hype is for Dark Souls 3.
Damn.
I was kind of cool on this one. I got to be honest with you. Like, I knew I was going to play it. You know, I got what's that game called? I already forgot. Salt and Sanctuary.
Salt and Sanctuary.
And I was kind of getting a little excited, but it wasn't until I've been listening to people talk about it on podcasts, and people talk about the older ones and stuff, and like I realize I really love Dark Souls, man. Even at its worst, it's still gonna be great. Like, you know, y'all heard me talk kind of mess about Bloodborne, but I still love that game. It's so good.
You know why I'm excited for Dark Souls 3?
Why?
Because I'm playing Dark Souls 1 right now. And sorry, that's we digress. I'll talk about that later. Keep going.
I'm excited because I'm going to go a dex build. This is going to be like the first Souls games where I ever go a dex build.
What are you going a dex build because that's what you did in Salt and Sanctuary? Or just
no,
because...
I didn't. I went strength in
Salt and Sanctuary. That's right, you did.
Am I making a mistake? I'm like the guy who puts a point into dexterity every like 7 or 8 levels.
Yeah, that's weird.
That's the thing with Souls games, Nick, is you can do whatever you want. Yeah. I mean, you should probably try and focus.
I feel like I'm playing it wrong.
My sweat for this week is my sweat for this fucking year because I am not finishing games. I'm going to talk about a game tonight that is not related to anything else. I have not finished anything. I have not finished The Witness. I have not finished XCOM. I have not finished Darkest Dungeon. I have not finished Fire Emblem.
Way to be a fucking
quitter,
Brad. I have not finished
Salt and Sanctuary, even though I'm really close to that. Like, I'm just not finishing games. And like, you know what? I'm kind of at peace with it. It doesn't mean I'm not going to finish those games because I still enjoy all of them. But then now Dark Souls is coming out and like, I'm kind of at peace with it. It's okay. You know, I kind of stopped thinking about it in terms of, you know, awards at the end of the year. It's just, I'll get to it when I get to it. You know what I mean? We'll say my fuck you. My thank you for this week is what Capcom said today about Resident Evil 2. They say it's coming along. And they're taking criticisms to Resident Evil 6, you know.
To heart.
And that is good fucking news. Which means that maybe this won't suck. Because fuck Resident Evil. Fuck Resident Evil 6. That's not my fuck you.
When you think about
Resident Evil 6.
When you think about it, the other Resident Evil remake that they've done was like probably the shining, like one of the shining stars of Resident Evil in the past, you know, however many years. When did they come out? Like a decade?
No idea.
I don't know. Besides Resident Evil 4, whatever.
And my you know what fuck I mean. You goes to Square Enix. And we're going to talk about a certain game later on in this episode.
Oh man, are we going to come to blows on this?
All I'm saying is they're throwing around a lot of money for this one game that was originally Versus 13. They're throwing around a lot of money that could have probably been used to fund other projects that they don't care about anymore. Just saying, you know, a Front Mission game for a 3DS, a Vagrant Story like reboot. You know, they're throwing around a lot of money.
We'll get to it.
We'll get to it. Yeah, we'll get it's to just that. A fuck you for now. So I don't have to bring down that new segment.
Okay.
Go ahead, Nolan.
Yeah, my 4Player...
Words, Nolan, words.
My hype is for Dark Souls 3. Brad fucking stole it. I'm pretty fucking excited for it. I've been kind of avoiding any... a lot of people have been streaming it lately, and I've been avoiding that coverage just so I can... I like to go into Dark Souls Raw. And so I'm
wrong. There's a joke to be made there.
Raw dog,
are you going to choose the class with no stats?
No, I don't do that. That's silly.
But I think he. I think deprived. What he meant to say is he likes to go into it blind.
The level one class. I like to be surprised by things.
Yeah.
My
like
sweat.
A finger in the butt.
Yeah. My sweat goes to Enter the Gungeon. I got a thing for roguelikes, and I'm afraid I'm going to play way too much of this game.
The game has a lot of charm.
No, definitely. It definitely does. There's 170 different weapons. Even when I was playing it before the feed, I was finding weapons I'd never even heard of before.
Did you find a t-shirt cannon?
I found a t-shirt cannon. I found like a shotgun that shoots water. I found just like a super soaker and just like all these crazy fucking one that shoots like cannonballs that explode.
Have you found the gun yet that shoots guns?
No.
Do those guns shoot guns also?
Maybe. I don't know. I would not, but I know there's a gun that shoots swords.
I was half joking. Is there really a gun that shoots
I would
guns?
Not be surprised. There's a DLC gun that shoots
shoots rare items.
Yeah, well, it shoots like pre-order bonuses.
Yeah.
So it shoots like CDs
but it uses your money as ammo.
Yeah, correct.
Like, yeah.
That's funny.
Yeah.
That is funny.
My fuck you this week. Oh, I had it and I lost it. I should have wrote it down like Brad did. It's probably going to go to myself. Mainly.
There we go. How about that? Chris Davis is just giving you one.
I don't really. That's not the end of the world. Removing the Fat Drake from Uncharted 4. All previous Uncharted games have, once you've beaten them, you've been able to change Drake into Fat Drake. Meh. That's not the end of the world. Yeah. Yeah.
I didn't even know that was a thing until I saw the news headline.
Yep. My fuck you is going to go to myself, mainly for how I, this past weekend, how little gaming I did. It's kind of one of those things where I was very active over the weekend doing like errands and stuff like that. And then when I got home, I wasn't in the mood to play games.
That's the
even
worst.
Though I knew I should have.
And worst.
So I just kind of sat on the couch and watched some TV. I did
work on
a personal project. A little bit in Naruto. That show's hard to watch.
How far did you get?
I don't know. I'm like,
all right.
Yeah, anyway.
We're not talking about Naruto this week. I listened to last week's podcast. There was no Naruto conversations happening.
I believe it. I believe whatever. And then my thank you this week is going to go to Square Enix.
Thank you.
What?
Thank you, Nolan. Well, I don't even know you're saying thank you for, but
well, I was just gonna say for finally, it's less of a thank you and more of a fuck you, for the press conference. That was a horrible fucking press conference,
dude.
It was so bad. Like they tried, they stretched out half an hour's worth of content into an hour and like 50 minutes.
Yeah,
it was ridiculous. They had these are so many announcements we're gonna make, and half the announcements weren't announcements, and the biggest announcement for last was the thing that already gotten spoiled during the day that they had previously commented on.
Dude, I was so disappointed
because when they didn't like bump up the
because
date
I was like that the release date for Final Fantasy 15 leaked like earlier that day. I was amazed they didn't like at the last second change it, like move it up a day, because who the fuck, like if it can come up the 30th, I'm sure they can have it ready to go up by the 29th.
They can't just change on there's probably like weeks of meetings about that release date,
dude. Final Fantasy, the Square Enix spending needs to sell, like they're spending so much fucking money in this game, they could fucking move it up a day if they wanted to.
I don't know, Nick, 10 years in the making. They need that extra day.
Dude, the game's already done. They're all already fucking done.
Parasite Eve remake.
I don't have my phone. I can't do my 4-player minute.
Okay.
Fucking assholes.
I was...
Pick that up! Get over here and pick that up!
We need to do the podcast. It's on the box.
That was actually Nolan.
I know it was.
I didn't have
and
it.
And he's giving it home like, I have no idea what you're talking about.
So your fuck you goes to Nolan.
I have absolutely no idea. This is impossible. Okay, my hype this week, obviously, is for No Man's Sky. Also, for all the Metroidvanias I've been playing lately.
Jesus, that is true.
Maybe in the future, your 4-player minute can be brought to you by No Man's Sky.
This week's hype brought to you by No Man's Sky is completely unrelated games. So Metroidvania, so over the weekend, last weekend, finished Super Metroid. Loved it. Still playing Castlevania Symphony of the Night. Loving it. I also started playing Axiom Verge. Played about 6 hours of that.
Damn. Jesus fucking Christ.
Love that.
Deep dive.
Dude, it's so good. I'm already like looking for the next one. Like, I'm just like waiting.
Wait, have you played Shadow Complex?
No. I'm going to get it when it comes out on Steam in May.
When you play Shadow Complex, you're going to be like, oh man.
Yeah.
Super Metroid.
I know. God, Super Metroid could learn a lot from this game.
Wait. My sweat is... for Quantum Break, actually. I really want to like this game. I think the Xbox needs something to light a fire under its ass.
Well, Quantum Break's also coming out on PC.
Well, apparently the PC port's like so dog shit.
I'm 99% sure any Microsoft Xbox One game that's coming to PC is probably going to have a shitty PC port.
Dude, apparently they forgot to put an exit game option in the menu for it. The only way you can close the program is to Alt-Tab and close it in the taskbar or hit...
Alt-F4?
Or Alt-F4.
Oh, man.
That's ridiculous. The only way you can close Quantum Break on
PC. So what you're saying is Quantum Break is still Xbox One exclusive.
Yeah,
that's ridiculous.
And it doesn't even run like a stable 30 on PC.
I see what they did there.
Yeah, it's ridiculous.
I bet you what's going on is when you play it on PC, it's actually Microsoft running it on a console and they're just streaming it to your PC.
Oh,
that's probably what's going on.
They've got an Xbox in the world somewhere playing it. Yeah. I think it looks cool and I like time travel stories. I want to see a game with an interesting time travel mechanic done well. I don't want to see this game fail, but I have a feeling it might not do so great if by no other fact than
you mean that it's from a financial standpoint.
Well, yeah, I mean it's an Xbox One exclusive, effectively, which
I hope it does
wasn't
good,
good for Rise of the Tomb Raider.
I hope it does okay since Remedies doesn't put out games very often.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, my thank you is no my fuck you for the week. Is split in half. Half of it, a large portion of my fuck you for the week is going to be reserved for Zack Snyder for a while. I
don't know. My fuck you of the week brought to you by Zack Snyder.
Brought to you by my hatred for Zack Snyder. Zack Snyder is like the Mercury Steam of people.
Right.
Not directors.
See, he plays half of Symphony of the Night and he already understands.
Not directors.
The
worst.
And the other half of my fuck you for the week was Konami, because the other night when I was playing Castlevania Symphony of the Night, I had this thought where I was like, wait, this is a Konami game.
Yeah.
This isn't coming back.
Nope.
Like, that's it. It's gone. Like, it's done.
Dude, when Konami shit the bed, they literally sent, like, three of, like, the industry's, like, of some of their biggest franchises down the shitter. Metal Gear, Silent Hill, Castlevania, all dead, essentially.
Yeah, like, just...
That is disgusting.
Just fuck.
Anyways.
Fuck, man. And my thank you goes to everybody who came back for the remainder of Project M. That was a lot of fun. That was kind of weird. We split it up over the course of a week. But
yeah, it's my fault.
God damn. Super Metroid's fun. I'm really glad we did that.
Me too.
Nick, bring us home. You want to go to sleep?
Let me start with my fuck you of the week then. While we're at it. I'm one is, this is my Fuck You of the Week brought to you by Ridley.
Scott?
Ridley. No. Of Super Metroid.
Oh, Ridley.
Oh, the bot Ridley.
Ridley the boss.
A boss.
The shittiest boss in that game.
I gotta say, I find it humorous that you struggle with Ridley in Super Metroid, but not Meta Ridley in Metroid Prime, who I think is way more annoying.
I fought Ridley probably like 20 times. And what's super frustrating about the whole thing is that I got him to, like, the red, like, the point where it was probably just a few hits away from killing him every fucking time.
Yeah.
Every time. And then I died.
Which sent me
spiraling into a, like, I was prepared to, like, play more Metroid after I finished Super Metroid. And now I'm kind of like, as much as I want to keep playing more Metroid games, like, I'm going to take a break for a while because I can't do it again. It's unfortunately, like Link to the Past, this game is probably going to go down in history as like one of my most frustrating experiences playing a game. I had a rough time.
It's my goddamn fault.
It's always Brad's fault.
And it's all Brad's fault.
Let's ruin another Super Nintendo game.
It's like Brad loves to shove his most beloved games down Nick's throat until Nick hates them.
I hate them with the fire. No, don't get me wrong.
It didn't have to end up that way.
Wait, we need to shove Chrono Trigger down his throat. Now we need to make him hate Chrono Trigger.
Yes. So I'll talk a little bit about my thoughts on Super Metroid. I know, Crispy, y'all talked in depth about it last week. I'll just kind of cover my thoughts on it later. My hype. This is a weird one. My hype. I'm getting excited for Game of Thrones Season 6.
What?
Predominantly because I've almost rewatched the entire series in the past 2 weeks. Just because, you know, I'm reading the books right now. I'm enjoying the books. And, you know, this is the first time we're going to be watching a season of the show where no one really knows what's going to happen. And that in and of itself is kind of exciting.
Yeah.
It could be terrible. It could be great. I have no idea, and that's kind of what's making it exciting. My sweat and also partially hype is for Final Fantasy XV. Huge Final Fantasy fan. Wasn't quite as burned by Final Fantasy, or didn't quite come out the other side of Final Fantasy XIII feeling as burned as a lot of people did. A lot of that has to do with...
You played the whole trilogy,
The whole trilogy, and that's part of the reason.
And I think you're the only one of us that did.
Got far more enjoyment out of the second two entries.
And Singularity's pretty good.
And Bloodstone is also great. Fuck you, Brad. Fuck you.
He started it.
Don't be Donald Trump. Sorry.
What?
But my sweat for Final Fantasy has to do with the future of the series because they really, like Brad said, they're banking a lot on this. Yeah. They have to sell 10 million copies to break even on this game.
I don't think that's preposterous.
But also, like, they're putting a lot of, like...
So me and Ed were talking about it. That's with the number of PS4s and Xbox Ones out there, that's 18% of the market has to buy Final Fantasy 15 over the life of the game. Not in the first year, game.
How many copies?
18%.
10 million, which is 18% of the consoles that are currently out there.
Of the install base.
Yes.
An 18%. "Quote unquote market penetration."
Yes,
is that common? Like, what do most games end up doing?
It's not that common.
We're gonna talk more about that later in the podcast.
Yeah.
Let me finish my my 4Player minute and my thank you this week. I'm gonna go ahead and give it to any and all people who are being very helpful to me on Twitter and whatnot and in chat with Dark Souls. I'm playing Dark Souls again, which I'll also give you all a brief update on a little bit.
He just finished early game.
I just finished. Yeah. I mean, I thought I hit like a huge milestone last night. It's like, congratulations.
Oh, Sen's Fortress. Is there like a final boss at the end of that or something?
Fuck me. But you know, everyone's being very helpful and supportive, which is great, especially I need it in that game. Because goddamn.
Dragon's Tail.
Thanks, Brad. But yeah, I'll talk a little bit about Dark Souls in a minute. So why don't we just jump into the meat of it? We have a lot of games to talk about tonight.
That was a weird sound effect.
That was not me. We're going to talk a little bit about Final Fantasy XV Platinum Demo. We'll talk about the Doom Beta. We'll talk about Stardew Valley. We'll talk about Super Metroid. Talk a little bit about Dark Souls. Talk about Nier. Played Nier.
That's a little random.
Yeah. But well, we've been telling them to play Nier for a long time. So we have a lot of games to talk about. Nier?
I hope you don't poop on Nier.
Well, do you want to start with Nier?
That's a weird one to start with. I think we should start with Doom. Or
fine, let's get Doom out of the way. Right, I'm the only one here.
Another game.
I'm the only one who played Doom.
Dumb.
Correct.
Doom.
I will say that myself and my lovely fiance were enjoying an evening together, which we rarely get to
playing Doom.
Which we rarely get because she works evenings, so we usually don't get to spend evenings together. We decided to have dinner and watch a movie. And Chris Davis sent me 9 fucking invites to play Dune with him while we were trying to watch a movie.
Turn off those, Jesus, turn Chris off those notifications.
Learn to take a hint.
Yes, no, I ended up
You think
turning,
after the fifth time you would have figured it
I,
out.
I ended up turning off the notifications because I was trying to watch a movie with my fiance.
He was sending me invites while my system was off and I didn't have the game installed on it.
I received a carrier pigeon. It said, play Doom with me.
I went outside and I saw a flare going up in the distance.
It was skywriting. There's a guy in a,
that
in a plane skywriting.
That must
sky
be Chris Davis.
Doom!
So there is no Chris.
I played a little bit of Doom, and by that I played like 2-3 hours.
The community
with
night,
the community
right?
on yeah. Saturday. I feel a little bad. You know, Chris Davis isn't in here to talk. He could talk more about it than I could. Honestly, I don't have any history with Doom multiplayer, and this was obviously a multiplayer-centric demo.
Mm-hmm.
So I was a little surprised when I popped in Doom and started playing it. And I was like, Jesus Christ, this feels like, I don't know, it feels like a weird mashup between like Halo and Unreal Tournament or something.
Yeah, because it looks like
a, that's what it is.
That's exactly like that.
Yeah, it does. It does. Yeah, which you know I wasn't necessarily expecting.
What the fuck is a revenue?
So where to start with this? The weirdest thing about this demo, but. So, would y'all say that you would probably expect at the very minimum to be some butt rock in this
thing? Yeah.
Yes.
There's no music.
Really?
It is completely silent.
What?
Is the butt rock?
It is completely silent.
Is there diegetic music at least?
No, there's no music. Actually, sorry, I hit the back. There is music in the menu when you're waiting to start the match, and as soon as the match starts, it's quiet.
Wow. It's just like a really
just
serious.
Ambient sound and gunshots, and it's, you know, it's weird. I wasn't expecting that. It's a little weird.
I would expect Doom to be like on the forefront of,
dude,
of
this would be
edge butt metal.
This would be the first game I would consider playing with like custom soundtracks.
Huh.
Like, because I have a lot of my own personal
you,
butt
you don't
rock.
Wanna, you just yeah. don't want to play back that YouTube video?
Oh.
I mean, I literally, the first thing I did with this game is I muted my microphone because I was broadcasting, and I pulled out my iPhone and started listening to my own music while I was playing, which I never do that.
You're off your iPhone?
Well, I mean, I wasn't prepared for there to be no music. I just booted up the game. I was like, what the fuck? Where is the music?
Do you think that's how it's going to be in the final game, or just because it was in the beta and maybe they didn't have the finalized music yet?
It definitely feels to me like there is something missing. Which, I don't know. So, I was playing my own music, you know, but the important thing here is that it's fun. I don't know how true this is to, like, Doom multiplayer, because I've never really played Doom.
Doom is like the original game with Deathmatch.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah, I know, but I never played any
of that. Which means,
I mean,
it's been copied enough that you played it.
Yeah, and it feels very familiar. Like, and it has a lot of those modern updates that you would come to expect, like the ability to, like, jump up walls and like pull yourself up and like leap over things, you know, things that were kind of introduced with games like Brink and Mirror's Edge and stuff, and they've incorporated over the years, have become synonymous with like first person shooters. It's very fast, which, you know, maybe although the people I was playing with seemed to express that maybe it was not as fast as they would have expected, given that it's a Doom game, because this is a game where, you know, you don't really ever want to stop moving. But I don't know, it's fun. I really like what I'm really digging about this is like the aesthetic and like the oomph that all the weapons pack. They do feel nice.
The dance animations.
The Carlton. The first thing I did in this game was the Carlton on accident, which is like that's literally the first thing.
I heard you can like dodge bullets.
But is the dancing like a taunt?
Yeah. Okay. It's funny. I was chasing after two dudes and they ran behind like a column and I saw like one guy take out the other and I came around the corner and that guy was standing over the corpse of the guy he had just killed doing the Carlton and I just fucking blew him away. That's funny. But
the dangers
I don't know.
Of
I think there are certain balancing issues with this game. I think some of the weapons, like the super shotgun, would you expect to be a pretty important weapon in a Doom game? I would imagine.
Yeah.
It doesn't. I used it like twice and was like, I'm probably, unless they change this,
you
I'm
sure
not using
it
anymore.
You sure it was a super shotgun?
Yeah, it's called a super shotgun.
Is this Chris Davis playing?
No, I think this is actually a match that Chai Tai recorded.
This is Chai Tai.
Whoever is playing this has been using the super shotgun a lot.
Yeah. You know, I mean, and that's
sorry, doesn't look like a super shotgun.
That's not it.
No.
Most of their kills have been with that shotgun.
Well, no, it's because they whatever this charged weapon is, they charge it, get a hit in, and then switch to the shotgun to finish him off.
Yeah. Yeah. Super shotgun Plasma was introduced in Doom 2, and it was like, hey, let's do the shotgun again, but now it can, like, like kill like 8 enemies at once. It was pretty awesome.
You know, yeah. I think the one of the cool, like, I was, you know, I was having fun, but I wasn't like, this isn't like blowing my skirt up or anything. And then I got to this point where I basically, there's a, on the map, periodically a upgrade loads that when you get it, you turn into a demon. Which basically, that was that big tall guy running around that you saw, and he has like dual rocket launchers, and you pretty much kill anything in one hit, and like, you're just a fucking powerhouse when you're in that. And like, that, I think that's probably like a, gonna cause some balancing issues, because Jesus Christ, like, I was,
you can't, you just know, pick, I'm not that very thing, good at
this
though,
game,
right?
I started this game, I wasn't doing very well, I was getting like maybe six or seven kills per match, and suddenly I played a match where I became the fucking demon, and I got 15 kills, just wow, running around just destroying everything.
How long,
but like, the moment it happened, it felt fucking awesome.
How long do you get to be the demon until you die? Is there a time limit?
It's a time limit.
It's a revenant.
You either die or you
Chris Davis says 60 seconds.
But yeah, so 60 seconds. So you can run around for a minute.
Why are you not using, where's the rocket launchers? That's what I want to know. Please tell me that's
there is a rocket launcher.
I saw someone using it earlier.
Okay.
Yeah, it's weird because that's like a primary weapon. You just run it, like, people are just running around using a rocket launcher.
That's what makes these fast-paced arena fighters fun, a rocket launcher.
I would always, in games like that, I would always just like shoot at hallways from like across the map, because I'm like, I'm sure someone's about to walk out of there.
So, I mean, there's not a whole lot to say. I only played, you know, a couple hours of it, and it's fun. I might dabble in this a little bit. I'm still predominantly interested in Doom for its single player campaign, but like, I don't know. I want to see what the maps are certainly kind of are fun to run around in. They have lots of cool warps and stuff, and some of the upgrades that are unique to the map that you don't start with. You can actually find them around the map. Like, there's some special weapons that you can unlock that you can't like. There's loadouts in this game too. I forgot to mention that. So you can't really add them to your loadout, but. You know, you find cool things around the map that make the matches really fun.
Am I the only one who's, like, not really kind of getting, like, a unified aesthetic with this game? Like, I feel like it's kind of...
I'm sitting here watching this, and it just looks so generic sci-fi.
It,
like, if you didn't tell me this was Doom, I would have no idea.
Oh, no, totally. This
Section 8.
This does not look like Doom.
I think the other map, like, the map that you're watching here, I think is probably more... what you're saying. Like, if you look at the other map, it does feel a little more Doom. It feels like you're running around in hell. There's, like, blood coming out of the walls. There's, like, all sorts of, like, satanic symbolism.
Lots of aborted babies lying around.
Yeah. Basically.
Yeah.
It may take that aesthetic as far as it could have, but, you know, it looks better.
Saying it just looks like Halo is kind of a disservice to Halo, because
I think this is going to be divisive, because it doesn't do anything revolutionary. It doesn't do anything super unique, but it is fun. And, you know, I think at the end of the day, that's probably what's important. Well,
I'm not one who cares about multiplayer.
No, I mean, honestly, I was way more impressed with that single player demo they showed of Doom at E3 last year than I am of the multiplayer beta. But it's fun.
I mean, the what they showed at Demons and Chainsaws.
Sorry,
and
my favorite thing about this demo, and this is probably the one thing, I don't know if I'd call this like unique, but it, you know, it's probably the one thing that stands out, is you have, I think they're called hacks. So when you, I guess in some cases, they're comparable to what you would have as like kill streaks, but instead of being tied to like actually killing dudes like in Call of Duty, you put these hacks on you, and they're actually limited. As you like play matches, you unlock hacks, and each time you equip a hack to your character, you start each match with that hack. But
is it a burn card?
Yes.
Yeah, I guess it's a burn card.
God,
so.
I hate games.
I don't know. I thought it was fun.
Hey, as long as they don't sell packs of them.
Oh yeah. Well, I can't comment on whether they're gonna sell us hacks, which they probably are, I'm guessing. But you know, standalone in and of itself, those were pretty cool. There is fun to be had here. I just don't know.
I think
the biggest thing that took me back was just the fact that it was fucking quiet. Like, it was weird. Like, there was, we were playing Doom on the feed, and there were these odd moments of, like, silence, of, like, dead air, and a broadcast where you're playing Doom, which felt weird.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, that's Doom. I'm still looking forward to playing it, but I'm still predominantly looking forward to that single player.
I think we all are.
Yeah. So
I'm hoping for that old school level design, like Chris Davis promised me after that one QuakeCon he went to.
That Doom is back?
Yeah, that Doom is back.
I don't know. We haven't really, I mean, all we have to go on with the single player demo or the campaign is what we saw at E3 last year. And that was pretty cool. I was really excited about Doom after watching that presentation. I know maybe that didn't do it for you, Brad, but it got me excited about Doom.
Didn't Chris Davis say Doom is back and you will be ashamed of your words and deeds?
But I don't know if he was necessarily...
Something like that.
I don't know if he was referring to the multiplayer, maybe?
No, he was definitely referring to the single player.
Yeah, that's what I'm going to guess. But anyways, we'll talk more about Doom in May when that game comes out. For sure. Who wants to talk about a game next? Nolan?
I'll do it.
Tell
I'll
us
take
about
one
Nier.
For the team. So Nier. So Nier's a new game that just came out.
What?
In 2010.
Yeah, working on it, I think. Oh.
What made you pick this up?
The year that I joined the podcast.
Nolan?
Well, if you had watched my 2016 preview show earlier this year.
I didn't think you ever posted that.
It went up like last week.
On April Fool's Day, actually.
That's
out there, by the way. Y'all go watch that.
So Nier is Nier Automata.
Oh, I fucking love this game.
Is
I'm
one
sorry.
Of my most anticipated games of 2016.
I think are we calling it Autonoma? Or are we calling it Automata or what?
I mean, it doesn't matter. It whatever.
Automata. Automata.
Latin pronunciation.
Is it?
But man, the moment I saw this footage, man.
Automato.
I mean, isn't it in reference to machines, like an automaton?
Yes.
But that's like a westernized pronunciation.
I should not have asked this question.
Oh my god.
Yeah. Okay. Anyway, so Nier has literally been on my bucket list since the year I joined the podcast.
As it should have been.
When it came out, I was in college. I didn't have a whole lot of money. And I never got around to playing it.
This is not one of those games that people were like, God, if only I had the money, I'd go out and play Nier. Like, no one even knew this game existed. But
I mean, I knew just because I had heard from y'all, and I was like, oh, it's good, it's good. And I was like, eh, whatever.
And the people who play it.
Yeah. You know what? I didn't even have an Xbox, or I think I had a PS3 at the time. Yeah, anyway. So it's been on my bucket list forever. Finally got around. I'm like, you know what? I'm going to play Nier. So I booted it up last Thursday on my broadcast. Nier's a pretty fucking good game.
Yeah.
First of all, I will also note, even though I've never played the game before this past week, I probably listened to the soundtrack about 20 times.
Yeah. Dude,
and I knew the soundtrack was good.
This is one of the few games I could think of where I'm legitimately, before I even see the game, I am excited purely based on the fact I know the music's going to be awesome.
Yeah.
Same composer is returning.
Nice. Yep. It's definitely good music. I've played now about maybe 5 or 6 hours of the game. How long is it?
Like, that's a tricky question.
Endings. I know that.
I think because I only played it. I played it to the point where you get the ending, and then I played a little bit past that. I think I spent
first
like 20, like, 25 hours.
I'm not eating. Whoa, I'd say like a first playthrough is probably only like 15 to 20 hours.
Okay, cool.
And then you could do like. Get the second.
Yeah, I heard there's multiple endings. I heard you like when you start your second playthrough, you don't start at the very beginning. You start like a little ways.
There's
into
a lot
the game.
Of like weird asterisks though when someone says play Nier. Mm-hmm. Like the first and foremost is like never do a side quest.
I've been doing all the side quests
because they're terrible and they're not worth it.
So
with the exception of the one that gets you the boar drifting.
I don't have that yet.
So there's one side quest that'll let you ride the boars.
I can ride the boars. Yeah.
Oh, okay. So you already did.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. I guess I did that one.
That's
that was gonna be one of my biggest poo-poos on this game.
Is the boar riding?
Is the quest tracking?
Oh.
Yeah.
It is atrocious. You can't switch which quest is your primary one. It will sometimes make side quests like show up on your map. Like, it's really silly, and I don't understand it, and you have to, like, go in there.
What's that weird square on the middle of your screen? You see that? The black square?
Yeah, that's Grimoire Weiss.
Yeah, that's...
Oh, it's the book! That's the book! Oh, it just looked like this... The screen's dark. It looks like it's just a black rectangle floating around.
No,
like, what is that?
It's Weiss. It's the book. He's shooting the magic,
Oh, I see him now.
Yeah.
There he is.
Weiss, you dumbass.
Yeah, I love how that's the... That's every time you start the game. Weiss, you dumbass.
That's so good.
The quest tracking is so bad, especially because there's some side quests that I've done that are actually like, did you do the old? So you didn't do a lot of the side quests. Did you do like the old lady in the lighthouse?
Yeah.
Dude, that was like a fucking, like, some of the writing in this game is really good.
Oh,
like,
yeah.
I don't want to spoil it for anybody.
A lot of it's not worth it.
Yeah.
The side quests, but some of this stuff is really
the good writing is incredible. The not so good writing.
There's I don't know where you are in the game, but like there's some I just don't want to say anything. I don't want to spoil anything.
So the last major thing I did, I guess, was I was in the junk area, and I was like, there's two kids, and they were like, find our mom.
Yeah.
And I did all that stuff. And
you did that kind of dungeon there?
Yeah, I did that dungeon. And I fought the giant robot with the hands.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The very... Yeah.
Yeah.
So there's some cool bosses in this.
Oh, definitely. I mean, that one... I don't want to say, like, Nier's ripping games off, but I mean... That was
very Zelda.
Yeah, that was very Zelda. You had to throw bombs in his mouth. You know, but anyway... But yeah, so I wish that there was a better way to track side quests, just because I don't want to do them all. It's just I would like to be able to switch active quests. I mean, once again, it's an older game.
That's one of the things I'm really like. That's kind of why I'm excited. Another reason I'm excited for the new ones, because I have a feeling they're gonna
they're definitely gonna fix a lot of that. Yeah.
The thing is, I don't even know technically what genre of game it's gonna be. Like how is that game gonna be structured? I mean, like, is it gonna be anything like Nier 1? Like, or what?
Yeah, I don't know. It's a good question.
Crispy, did you play Nier? I can't remember.
I have never played Nier.
You should.
You should.
I haven't.
You should.
It's an odd thing.
It's a Metroidvania. Did I tell you that?
What? Yeah. Elements of that.
No.
I think he was just trying to get into
it. I was
trying
to get him to play it.
Oh. It's a game that's constantly changing what it is in some pretty clever ways.
And yeah, so that's the thing is, every time. It almost makes me think, I don't want to say, the world is almost enslaved-esque, but you're in this kind of, like, post-apocalyptic kind of type world. And there's, you know, kind of, like, this element of robots, like, technology, and kind of, like, a magical element as well. And you don't ever, you know, there's this whole, like, kind of this like, disease thing that you're trying to help cure.
Her name's Kine, right? Kine? Mm-hmm.
Kine.
Yeah. She's a great character. I've only seen her after this. I haven't seen her since.
She's a great character.
I will say that the opening video shows her getting pierced in the chest by something, and I'm like, that's nice. I don't know if that's a spoiler. I don't know what the guy. I'm not gonna. Don't tell me. I'll find out when I get there. But yeah, so I've definitely the other big thing I will poo poo on this is there's a lot of running back and forth. So far, the world has not been that big. No. I've only been to
three. I don't think it ever is that big.
I guess technically four areas. And it's just a lot of running back and forth between them. Fetch quests kind of go here, do this, go back. Oh, now go back to where you just were and do this.
But now you can ride a boar.
And yeah, riding the boar does make things faster.
I just wish they hadn't named the boar Epona, but, you know, whatever.
Did they really?
No.
I don't think.
What is
with that?
That's
one?
Two, Crispy. That's
funny,
two.
Funny guy. Funny guy.
On your way to Seaport, I guess that's that one town at the sea. There's like, randomly, there's this giant fucking. What are they called? The enemies called starts with an S.
Shadow.
Is it shadow? Whatever. A giant like shadow
we'll
that
go
appears,
with shadows.
And he like one hit kills me. I don't think it's shadows. He's like some giant enemy that like one hit kills me. And sometimes I'll go back and he'll be there, and sometimes he won't be there. And I've tried to kill him, but I only do like...
Probably one of those things you should come back to.
Shades.
There we go. That's
Shades.
Correct.
Yes.
Shades. That sounds right.
Heartless, yes,
man, like,
exactly.
It's... Man.
What?
There's a...
Look at that loading menu, man.
There's some
so
crazy
good.
Stuff.
Yeah, the loading menu. And surprisingly, the loading is surprisingly quick. Especially for a 360. I'm playing this on the 360, and it loads surprisingly quick.
Well, it's not like it's got the greatest textures.
Oh, yeah, I will agree. There's not a whole lot going on in the world. It's fairly plain. Yeah. So that's probably one of the reasons it loads quickly. But it's still fun to be in this world. I still enjoy it. I enjoy rolling everywhere.
There's the Zelda thing.
Yeah. The right, like, just the interactions between the main character... does he have a name besides
Nier? It's Nier.
Oh, it is Nier.
Mm-hmm. Well, he's technically named, you can name
he's
him
Nolan
yourself.
In my game.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay.
Oh man, that what? Reminds me of
a thing. Crazy.
Yeah.
Okay. And so his interactions with Weiss. You know, Weiss is such a like snarky fucking character.
Mm-hmm. He's a book too, by the way.
He is a book. Yeah, a magical
he's
book.
He's a grimoire.
Yep.
We call them books, Brad.
Yeah, just his interactions. I'm surprised at how much voice acting is in this game. There's a lot more than I thought there was going to be.
That's good. This was localized by 8-4.
Even on some of the like smaller side quests, which I think wouldn't have. You know, normally in a game like this, the voice acting is kind of just for the main quest and main story elements. But there'll be random, like, you know, the whole, like, the lady in the old lady in the lighthouse, that, like, whole quest was voiced.
Do we know who's doing the translation or the localization for the new one? Because I hope it's 8-4 again, because they kind of nailed it with this one.
But yeah, so I mean that's all I really have to say so far. Like, I've only fought, you know, two bosses.
We'll,
I guess,
check back periodically.
I'm definitely gonna finish this game.
Do you kind of know like where it's okay to maybe stop and YouTube the rest? You know what I mean?
How do you mean?
Well, so there's four endings, but they're not like alternate ways of getting them. It's,
so I know you have to beat the game four times to see all four endings.
Yeah, but really. The stuff changes in the game on your second playthrough.
That's what I heard.
And your third and fourth, not much changes after that except for the ending.
Did you do all four?
No, I just did
Brad
two.
Brad would never do that.
I just did the two and I YouTubed the other two.
But so the other thing, there's a lot of cool things I didn't like. There's fucking like, you know, there's, you can upgrade your weapons. You can, there's like, I'm not craft, but you can like kind of go like a blacksmith type character and upgrade your weapons. There's like a whole harvesting mechanic where you can grow like crops.
Yeah.
I don't remember any of that.
So you had to finish a side quest, but yeah, and so like,
oh, those side quests that I never did.
A side quest that unlocks crops, and I planted some crops, and then I came back the next day and they grew. And I harvested them, and I guess that's a way to like make money. I guess you can just like farm crops.
That sounds to me like something that might come into play more second playthrough or something. I don't know, because I don't think I ever did any of that. I never knew the difference. Just
it's
playing
hard
right
to talk about this game at all without spoiling it.
Well, yeah, I definitely don't want to spoil it. But yeah, I don't know. It's an old school game. You got to save at checkpoints. Which, you know, whatever. It's I that's the other thing I want to talk about. I love that there are so many different camera angles in this game.
Yeah.
Like when you enter a building, you'll go into this side view, but it's not like
that takes me back to like some like older art, like old school RPGs. On,
yeah,
like,
and
PS1,
it's not
PS2
like
era.
It's the same engine. Just the camera's just locked in this one view, and you're kind of locked on a plane. And you'll be in a dungeon, and all of a sudden when you enter a door, the camera just goes above you, and you're now it's this top down isometric view when you're running around fighting things.
There's a mansion you go to later,
And
it goes straight up Resident Evil.
What? Yeah. Dude, this game's really good. I'm really excited to play more.
Cool.
I'm glad I finally got around to starting it.
Keep doing that, and we'll check back in with you.
Nice.
On a future show.
Definitely.
This is definitely a game you should keep going
animation.
With.
His double jump animation.
Dude, every time I'm in a house, I just jump, because he's just that weird kind of... It looks like he's being pulled up by his chest.
Yeah. Hey, Crispy.
Hey.
So you're playing Castlevania Symphony of the Night.
Ooh.
Yep, I sure am.
You finally listen to me. In my
recommendation.
Just remember, ultimately,
it's like
I was
drained,
doing it because I knew you would really like it.
It's like he drained all my enthusiasm for Metroidvanias out of me and just absorbed 100%, just ran with it.
Yeah.
Like a vampire.
Like a vampire.
Yep.
Like a Dracula?
Like some kind of sexy Dracula.
Do you think that playing through Super Metroid kind of gave you a better understanding for like maybe how to approach this game, maybe more respect for the formula, or like, well why do you think it clicked with you now post Super Metroid when it didn't click with you that
first time? I think playing Super Metroid first did kind of help me, did put me in a good mindset for
Symphony
of the
Night.
They're very different
games. Oh, they're definitely.
Well, they are, but structurally they follow the same like kind of metagame experience, you know? The only thing that's really different is that Castlevania is a bit more like
RPG.
Like, yeah, it's a bit more in depth.
Yeah.
Like there's just more to it, you know?
Yeah.
Super Metroid, I think, was a good starter experience. I think playing them in that order too was the way to do it.
Yeah,
I think
that's
Super
that's
Metroid.
What we did.
Well, Metroid's more of a, I would describe Metroid as more of a adventure game, and Castlevania is almost more like an RPG, isn't it?
Yeah,
well, I think that's exactly what's going on. Yeah.
I mean, you do get like like in Super Metroid, you get upgrades, you get different weapons, but they all kind of stack. Like nothing's, you're not really ever like going in like trying to select the right piece of gear, or the right piece of equipment for this situation. It's like, okay, I had the one suit, and now I have a better suit, which does everything the old suit did, and then some. You know,
yeah.
I have a gun that does everything the old gun did, but does more as well.
Yeah.
So there's never, you know, you're just on like one linear like upward path of progression. In Castlevania, there's so many different things you can do. Like there's so many different like items you can use. Like you can say, okay, do I want to use this really powerful two-handed sword, or do I want to use a shield and the shield rod? Like, or do I, you know, do I want to use these like thrown weapons?
But the shield rod gets really good later.
The shield rod is crazy, and that was another thing too that surprised me about Castlevania is how many like. How many really cool mechanics there are in this game that they don't tell you about that are hidden, and how useful those hidden mechanics actually are.
Yeah. It's very like Dark Souls. If you had to compare it to something modern where there's a lot of unexplained
secrets. Yeah, it feels like, fuck, man, if I beat this game and I didn't know that I could do something like the Hellfire spell, I would be pissed.
Dude, yeah, like, spells are something that, yeah, like, there's so many different spells and how you activate them. And, you know, I think it's one of those games where that when it came out, it wasn't meant to be played once. Yeah. You know, you were meant to play this game 4 or 5 times, you know, constantly, you know, figuring out new things. And, you know, this is you came out back in a day before, like, internet was readily available. And so, and so people would tell each other, oh, did you find this? And they would want to go and check it out. And so, I mean, you want, and it's something we've talked about. I don't want to say we're old people, but we kind of are, to the extent that fucking nobody has any patience nowadays. And to an extent, I'll say I don't have a whole lot of patience nowadays. Well, I just want a game to fucking get to the point.
I definitely have benefited from playing this in the stream and having like chat and Brad help me out.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, by the way, fuck this clock tower.
It's pretty bad. This is the worst. You play a Castlevania game, the clock tower is always going to be the most maddening.
Yeah. Dude,
that's just Castlevania.
I wasn't playing very good in this clip that we're watching here, but like I definitely just like shit the bed in this clock tower area.
Somebody was like, it's infuriating. Very in chat was like, hey, somebody basically recreated the conversation that probably happened. Mm-hmm. They were like, wait, how are Medusa heads going to be annoying when the character now has so much mobility? And Igarashi was like, oh, don't worry, I got it.
Look at this. I just keep getting stoned, like petrified over and over again.
That is what's going to happen every time. Bad.
In the later, in the later half of the game, can I say that?
Go ahead.
Should I not?
Spoil. Oh, you're talking about the spoiler?
Spoiler. Yeah.
No, that's like an Aerith dies kind of thing.
Yeah. Was I the only one who didn't really know?
Yeah,
like,
probably. Yeah, pretty much.
To be fair, so I'm considering playing this. So if there's any question of spoiling anything, let's not do that.
It's like a Snape kills Dumbledore sort of thing.
Yeah, let's not spoil that.
No,
then.
You know.
I don't. Let's move on. Okay. I don't want to spoil that.
Okay. Well, either way. The second version of that area that I played through was like even more maddening. It's unbelievable. Yeah. But oh my god, like I'm disappointed. But like I'm really into this game.
He's disappointed because he didn't want Brad to be right.
I didn't want to give Brad the satisfaction. This really goes beyond the whole meme of like Brad and me's joke argument. Oh, hey, Chris, you should play Castlevania. No, I'm not going to play Castlevania. Fuck you, Brad. And everyone has a good laugh. But all of that bullshit aside, I'm really glad that I'm playing this game. I was thinking about nothing but Castlevania all weekend.
Yeah.
Since I beat Super Metroid, this is all I've been thinking about. To the point where on Sunday, I was like, I really, really just want to sit down and play Castlevania. Like, I just want to sit and play it, but I didn't want to advance my save file any farther because a couple people in the feed last Friday when I was playing it had said, hey, if you're going to keep playing this, please play it on the feed. I want to be able to watch it. So I was like, okay, fine. I'm going to save this for the feed. And I was just sitting there Saturday like, or Sunday, and I was like, what am I going to play? Like, so I went to fucking Steam and bought Axiom Verge and sat and played that for 6 hours.
So that's why I was wondering why you also like double dipped.
I was like, I don't have. I'm like, I was like, ah, like I was like, I'm not gonna play Super Metroid again.
Do we
I'm
have
just
footage of
that.
Axiom Verge?
You know,
no, but I'll get some.
You know what you
or
should?
He might have some.
You know what you should? You have a 3DS, right?
Yeah.
You should get. Well, you're gonna finish the. I mean, we need to talk about. You were wondering where you should go next, basically.
Right. Like, what's the next thing? Like, I'm almost done. I feel like I'm almost done with Symphony.
I will
say
this: the one Castlevania, the one 2D Castlevania that I've played, Dawn of Sorrow, was fucking incredible.
That's the thing. I would recommend Dawn of Sorrow because Aria of Sorrow is the GBA game. You can play that on your Wii U, but if you get Dawn of Sorrow, you could kind of take it on the go on your 3DS or whatever, play it on the crapper. So the thing is, the Sorrow games are the ones that I think best Symphony of the Night in some very key ways.
So that's how I played this, because I played it before they re-released it on consoles, and so I played the Rondo of what was that one game? Rondo of Blood. Was that the one where you could unlock?
On
my PSP. I bought Rondo of Blood.
Well, you bought the Dracula X Chronicles.
Dracula X Chronicles, which just to unlock Symphony of the Night. I never played anything but Symphony of the Night on that game. But I played it on my PSP, and I was like you, to the point where I just wanted to play it, and so I was in my fucking linear algebra class, and instead of actually paying attention to my lecture, I was just playing this all class.
Dracula X Chronicles is the remake of Rondo of Blood, which is story-wise the prequel to this game, but it's also a classic Castlevania game and nothing like this.
Play as Richter in that one.
You play as Richter. Mm-hmm. And the start of this game, even though it says Bloodlines, which was a Genesis game, that was actually a mistake. It was actually the last fight of Rondo of Blood.
That's so fucking cool.
The thing is, once you beat this game, you can play as Richter through this game.
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
This is probably a dumb question. Is Symphony of the Night available on is there a version I can play on Vita, like as a download?
Yeah, you can play Dracula X Chronicles.
I unlocked this for you on your Dracula X Chronicles.
No, on my PSP, which I no longer own.
You can either download.
No, that was your Vita.
What? I don't own that on Vita.
It was no. You were definitely playing on a Vita.
You were on a Vita
when we unlocked it for you.
But how did I? I don't own that on a Vita. How did I get that on a Vita?
Maybe you downloaded it.
But
you can play PSP games on Vita.
But why would I have bought Dracula X Chronicles to unlock Symphony of the Night when I could have just bought Symphony of the Night?
Because I think you want to play
Because I think you wanted to play it on mobile.
Probably because I told you that's the version to play.
That was the superior version.
Because that one has Maria. You can also play through as Maria. And it is the most updated version.
Well, then, fuck it.
It has the retranslation.
I might play this on my Vita.
I'm 99% sure we unlocked it for you on your Vita.
Yeah, I remember you doing that, but I thought that was on my PSP back in the day. I guess not.
Mm-mm.
Okay, well, fuck it.
I mean, I'm really into this game. I'm a little...
I'm glad you finally got around to playing it.
It's like a Dark Souls game, where, like, the first time I tried to play, like, I was beating my head against the wall because it was so difficult in the beginning because you're so weak. But, like, once you get over that hump, once you start getting a grasp for the mechanics of the game, it just takes off.
This is a brilliant segue.
It just takes off.
Crispy, I'm glad you did this. Because I'm playing Dark Souls again.
What?
In fact, I've played... Because I actually took off from work because I was not feeling well last week. And I ended up sitting at home playing Dark Souls almost all day. So I'm like... And I know we don't have... I'm not going to talk very long about this. I don't have footage of it. But, you know, I'm 25, 26 hours into Dark Souls. Now I'm level 49, I think.
Mm-hmm.
I just rang the second bell. So I guess...
Of Awakening. The one down below.
I finished Blight, so you beat the spider. Yeah, I finished Blight Town and beat the spider. I'm not going to go into how to beat the spider because there's, I don't want to incite the wrath of Dark Souls fans.
It's called Don't Get Hit.
No, that's definitely not what it's called. but point is,
was it cheesy?
I beat the spider.
Was it pretty cheesy?
No, it's just, I took advantage of a mechanic that most people who play Dark Souls probably would say I shouldn't have done.
That's called
cheesing. Because I'm ruining my experience.
That's called cheesing. Wait, are you talking about summoning people?
Well, there's an NPC you can summon.
Like that's NPC fine. Summoning an NPC is fine.
Okay, I didn't know. Summoning other players is fine too, guys. That's like a pretty integral part of the experience.
I
summoning mechanic is perfectly fine.
There is one character in this game, and I actually read about this because I didn't realize what it was. I thought that someone invaded my game in Blighttown.
Yeah,
but that's actually an NPC, and I think it was apparently
that happens more than once.
But apparently, those are put there to kind of like introduce you to like the idea of how it works
because you haven't gotten to the PvP area yet.
Oh, there's a special PvP.
Once you get past a certain point in the game, then people can invade.
There's an area that's really popular for PvP that like.
Well, that's mainly because once you get to this area, then PvP's unlocked in your game. So people will often just hang out there invading people because it's probably the first time they've ever been invaded by someone.
What area is that in Blighttown?
And Orlando.
That's the place where people like.
That's where that happens.
So I finished Blighttown.
Out of the frame rate shit, Ben?
Well, dude, I had no frame rate issues.
Well, you're playing on PC with DSX, probably much better.
DSX made that smooth as butter. Yeah. I was
playing that on Xbox.
I had no idea what Blighttown was or what to expect from it. All I know is people always said that fuck that place. Yeah. They hate this place.
The frame rate.
It was the frame rate and the fact that there are enemies there that give you toxicity.
Poison.
Which is a fucking, like, poison. There are poison and toxicity dealing enemies there.
Yeah.
Both of those suck. Yeah, when the game is running normally and you can tell what's going on, those suck. When you can't, because the frame rate shit's the best.
Because so DS Fix managed to, I avoided any frame rate issues. It was smooth as butter, which is great.
The other issue with that area, I don't know if that's is like falling and lots of like making jumps and stuff. And doing that with a shitty frame rate is even harder.
So luckily I didn't have much problem with that. There was a couple times, especially when you're going up that big elevator. I may have missed a jump there once. But you also find somewhere in Blighttown, you find like a
ninja outfit or whatever.
It's like a thief or something, or a shadow outfit. Yeah, and that like reduces your toxicity.
I like when games, you know, like Souls and even Salt and Sanctuary is the same thing. You'll find an area, and if you find like an outfit or like an accessory or something that's like reduces poison, you're like, there's probably some enemies. I should probably equip this.
Yeah.
Like when you're in that area.
Yeah. So I will say this, like, I'm fucking loving this game.
Good. Glad it's got your hooks.
I mean, I Bloodborne was my first Souls game, so I didn't really know what. I was a little worried going back to the original just because, obviously, you know. It's older. It's probably a little more hardcore than Bloodborne, and you know, I wasn't quite sure what to expect. But like Crispy said, once you get past that hump and you stop being afraid necessarily.
Once you build some momentum.
And
with Dark Souls especially, I think it is like, especially nowadays, it's such a meme that like Dark Souls is impossibly hard, blah blah blah, and it's not. It's once you stop psyching yourself out,
and
you understand.
And I have reached that point.
You understand like how to approach a situation.
Yeah.
Oh, it's
like last night, I played for about 45 minutes last night. Beat the Hydra down in the Moonlight Garden or Basin.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And I didn't, like, I walked up and I was like, holy fucking hell, there's no way I can beat this. And I walked up. And by the way, chopping off the last head of that Hydra is a bitch because when there's one left and he's from the right side and he always goes around to the left and like rams his head into the ground, but it's like just barely off the shore. Like sudden drop off.
Mm-hmm.
You can't get too close or you just fall the fuck off.
Yeah.
And I was just sitting here and that was where the frame rate for me was chugging. So I'm sitting here waiting for him and trying to like reach and slash him, but I can like, it took me 15, 20 minutes to chop off that last head because I could never get a hit in. But I beat that. I beat that.
Do you do Synth Fortress?
I just unlocked Synth Fortress last.
He just rang the bell.
Oh, yeah,
that's what I'm saying. You're leaving.
The real
like,
Dark Souls starts
you're leaving.
Here.
See, I wish people would stop saying that because I just managed to stop psyching myself out.
It's not fun and crazy. What's cool is like, I think looking back, Sense Fortress is where the game like actually kind of like gets good.
It's not
like,
that it gets hard.
Fun.
Oh,
like it's like you're gonna go to like after you finish Sense Fortress, you're gonna go to another area that's unlike anywhere you've seen yet in this game, and it is a fucking amazing moment the first time you go there. There's moments after that game where the game actually stops and starts saying like, hey, now that you've been getting the shit kicked out of you for the last like 12 hours or so, let's just talk a little bit about what's going on. And kind of like tells you what's going to happen next. It feels like that point where it's like, okay, everyone who was going to quit playing this game has already quit. You're going to go for endgame, and this is what's going to happen. Like, it feels gratifying. Like, the game feels like it's finally opening up, and it's not, like, trying to weed you out anymore, you know?
Cool.
That's
exciting.
That doesn't mean it gets any easier.
No, no.
But a lot of cool story things start happening.
I'm really...
Give that one Covenant 40 humanity or
I'm
whatever,
really digging...
So you can avoid the worst area in the game.
Yeah. I'm really digging the chat. Like, you know, I'm glad... Honestly, I'm glad I played Bloodborne first because it does feel a little bit like it prepared me for just this kind of game.
Oh,
like,
yeah, for sure.
I'm loving the shit out of it. You know, a lot of that also is just, I love the world. I love the lore, you know, the sense of exploration. I'm kind of seeing what everyone talks about now in terms of the difference in the way the world is structured between 1 and 2, because I've played a little bit of 2. I don't know.
It's just one of those games where, like, every time I play a Souls game, I'm always, like, scared. I'm scared about what's around every corner. Every time I encounter a new enemy,
run with that
I'm
fucking
like,
shield
fuck?
Up, man, because you never know.
Yeah, and so that's the thing. And that's, now you understand why... When Bloodborne was announced and there's no shields, everyone who loves Souls is like, what the fuck are you talking about? No shields. What are you talking about?
Because you can't run.
You stupid.
You can't run with the shields up. That's
So for all of us who love Souls but aren't someone like Jaeger, who can fucking, you know, run through the game and fist everything to death.
He uses a ladle.
Or Mike.
A ladle.
I loved, you know, Dark Souls 2, but shields are very important.
It's going to be really hard for me, guys, because I'm getting really excited for Dark Souls 3, but I have made the decision. I'm not touching it until I finish 2.
Dude, I mean,
honestly, it probably won't take as long as you think.
I know,
now that
I know.
You're kind of starting to get through 1.
I'm finding my momentum.
Yeah.
You shouldn't be in a rush to play Dark Souls 3 anyways.
No.
Because it's not like that's going to give you an experience that's really that much better or anything.
I just know I want to play it before the end of the year. Yeah. So as long as I get to it before the end of the year, I'm fine.
I think you're in a really good spot. Like, you're in the part of the game where you're going to start getting access to a lot of, like, optional content. And there's a lot more to explore and a lot to see. And, like, things that you'll, like, stumble onto, they're like, what the fuck is this?
So there are a couple areas I've found that I'm not sure if I'm, like... Like, I stumbled into the catacombs. Is that a late-game area?
Not necessarily.
It's later than you probably
want to
be.
Yeah, you probably don't
want to
be in there right now.
I also assume I probably can't kill that dragon yet on the bridge, because he...
The one that's, like, playing dead until you get up on him?
The
one on the castle bridge.
We might
be talking a little too much.
I know, I know. I'm sorry. I got in the Dark Souls mode and felt like talking about it. Okay, sorry.
Really cool.
Anyways, what do we want to talk about next? We still got Final Fantasy 15. We still got Stardew Valley.
Yeah.
You want to talk about Stardew Valley?
Yeah. This is what's been consuming my life.
I've been hearing Stardew Valley on, like, every podcast I listen to, so let's...
Everyone's
talking about it.
A farming game like Harvest Moon. Not just a farming game. A game where you run and maintain a farm.
Has this game been out for a long time?
No, it just came out like a week or two ago.
Yeah. I thought I remember someone talking about it, like they've been playing it for a year or something.
Like alpha or beta or something
So, like, has anybody here played Harvest Moon?
Yes.
I have watched someone play Harvest Moon.
Long-ass time ago.
Animal Crossing?
I have played some Animal Crossing, yes.
Okay, so imagine Animal Crossing where you had to maintain a farm. But, like, you still have a town. There's people in that town. You could do quests for them. You're trying to build relationships with them. You're ultimately trying to, like, marry and fuck them.
All of them?
Well,
those escalated quickly.
So, I'm playing as Malia because we're playing it together, and this is our farm. We're growing cranberries right now. It's fall. And it's raining today, so you're not actually going to see me spend a lot of time watering my crops because I don't have to. So I'm going to go into the mines and kind of dungeon crawl.
Are those chocobos?
Those are chickens, Nick.
Those are just regular chickens.
Are those cuckoos? In the real world, they're called chickens. And they give you eggs.
I'm gonna
take my eggs over to my mayonnaise machine and make mayonnaise. Because, like I have fruit right now in my jam maker because, you know, it's all about, you know, the economy and making money so you can buy more crops, so I can, like, build a barn, so I can get cows, so I can make milk and sell that milk or turn that milk into, like, fucking omelets and shit.
I have a question, Brad.
Yes.
I've seen this game a little bit.
Yeah.
Do you know how long it is?
It never ends.
Well, what?
That's my fears. My fear is I'm going to play this game for like 60 hours.
Yeah, you are.
Over the next like 3 days.
Yeah. I mean, this game is super That's addictive because the game saves when you're done with a day.
Oh,
and when you wake up in the morning, it's like, oh my God, my crops come in. Oh my thing. God, like I have all this extra money now from overnight, you know? And it's like, you want to do another day and another day. And like, I've been addicted to this, and Malia never gets into games, but all the time, like before work, when she gets home from work, she's like, let's play some Stardew Valley. This game is addictive as shit.
When she's working and you're playing, does she ever call to check on the chickens from work?
No.
By the way, how's the crop looking?
Four chickens. Jippa.
You can name the chicken.
Cinnaboo. Well, we use the random name generator. Cinnaboo, with an S. Fricka, and Lockers. Those are our four chickens.
Which one's your favorite? I
like Cinnaboo.
I want to clarify.
He escaped once.
I want to clarify something real quick. You said you were growing cranberries,
That's
right?
That's my horse. Bubba the horse.
Cranberries grow in water, don't they?
No. Yeah, Mountain Doom said the same thing. Like, he said, I thought cranberries grow underwater. Actually, cranberries do not grow underwater. They grow...
Not under, in, like on top of.
No, they don't. They don't. They grow in regular fields, just like you see here. When it comes time to harvest, they flood the field, then they thresh all the plants because the cranberries are hollow, so they float.
They float
That's
the top?
Easiest way for them to harvest.
Oh!
The water only comes into play during harvest.
Every
Damn
day,
it, Crispy, you're
every,
so smart.
Every, I have four chickens, and every day they give me one egg. I turn three of them into mayonnaise, and by request of Malia, she chose her bow. We have to give one to Sam because he likes eggs, and we're trying to get in his pants.
What?
Because you can have kids in this.
You're trying to get the egg in his pants? You just crack it.
He likes eggs, so we give him an egg as a gift every day.
Shove an egg.
That's what gets it. That's how people get into my pants all the time.
Yeah.
How about eggs?
But like, it's just very addictive. It's like you know, you're raising money so you can build like a stable so you can get your horse, but you want to upgrade your tools because you know you upgrade your tools, you can like chop down like you know bigger trees that give you like different types of wood that will like. It's just this constant flow of like. Of you know, just it's just this addictive loop. It's raining today, so I'm gonna go to the mines. I'm gonna kill some slimes and mine for ores and stuff.
Slimes like Dragon Quest slimes?
Yeah, I mean this game has combat in it. I mean it's pretty simple, like Link to the Past or something. You're just kind of swiping at them and whatnot. But it's so good. The thing that's surprising about this game is like there's a lot of personality in like the town and like the town keepers and stuff.
How's the music?
Like it's this. The music's great. The And it changes depending on the season and stuff.
The game goes through seasons.
Yeah, it goes through seasons.
Of course it does. It's a farming game.
Yeah, only certain like plants will grow, grow, and you're trying to time it right because the crops will like summer crops will die at the end of the season. So you're like,
if you fuck up,
we can get four harvests of cranberries.
If you fuck up and you have like a bad harvest and you can't really make ends meet, can you mortgage your farm?
There's other stuff you
can
do.
Eat one of your kids.
So it's funny you say that because like there is like this dark underbelly. Like there's a lot of like personality and like little subplots going on, and one of them is like one of the main goals of this game is to restore. The community center, right? And like the thing is there's this place called like Jojo Mart. Like Jojo Mart, which is so everything runs on a clock, right? So like, oh, I want to go to the store and buy some seeds. Ah, well, it closed at 4 or whatever, so I missed it. I gotta wait till tomorrow. Well, there's like a Walmart place that like if you buy a membership card they have cheaper prices, they have long hours,
but it's not good for the community.
But like business. But I go in there and I'm like, and it's like, hey, you want to shop here? Buy one of the club cards or whatever. In fact, we just need to sell one more club card, and the mayor says we can build a Jojo Mart in the community center. So do you want to buy one? I don't think we should be doing this. There's like this whole like dark underbelly. Like one of the main things of like the game is to restore this community center, and I think you can like fuck up and like totally turn it into a Walmart. And it's like it's crazy because you're in this small town and you don't want that to happen. But you know we're struggling. Like oh, we got to get to the carpenter because this mom and pop carpenter is gonna fucking close at 4 o'clock because they got to go to Luby's.
If you had this whole like dilemma of like, oh well, I don't want to buy the membership because I want to save the community center. I don't want to get turned into another Walmart. And you're finally like, you know what? No. I'm going to shop local. And like as you're leaving, somebody else comes in and buys a membership and they're like, we're doing it. We're
just scared that local businesses
anyway. It doesn't matter.
Hey, you know what? That would be thematically kind of cool.
So, but can you set an alarm to wake up earlier in the morning?
Well, you always wake up at the same time, but like it's all like managing your energy, managing your day. Like I can only go into the mines when it rains because it takes so much energy to water your crops. But like you can buy sprinklers and upgraded sprinklers, and that's like getting like a fucking ultimate weapon or something, you know? Like being able to not have to water your crops. We can't do that now.
Oh my god!
But we're just thinking about irrigation. The winter. We're thinking about the winter. We're harvesting fruit and like storing it in our fridge so we can like survive through the winter making jam because you know those plants aren't going to grow during the summer.
You like, certainly can't jelly your cock down your throat.
Yeah. What?
But, wait. Can you wake up one day and be like, okay, I gotta go to the hardware store, get this stuff for my farm, blah blah blah. You get to the hardware store and they're like, oh, the kindly old man who runs the store is feeling very sickly and they didn't open today, and you're like, well, fuck, that just like ruined my whole day.
It happens because like you go to the store, oh, we're gonna buy some seeds. It's the first day of the season. Oh, we gotta get this. And it's like. You go to the shop, closed on Wednesdays.
No.
It's like, fuck! And it ruins everything.
Why are they closed on Wednesdays?
There's also cool little events, kind of like Animal Crossing or whatever, where, like, you know, different days and different seasons, like, shit happens. Like, we went to the flower dance, but, like, Malia had not improved her relationship with anybody because she was so focused on her farm early on that nobody would dance with us. They all kept rejecting us, and it felt terrible. And then we're like, well, we like Demetrius. We're going to hit on Demetrius. He got hooked up with somebody. Like, he's in a relationship now. So, like, we're running out of cool dudes. Some people are just straight up dicks.
You're just married to your farm.
But, like, these little events are cool. Like, I am a little bit of, like, kind of like the farm Gestapo when I play because... Malia has a hard time making decisions, and she feels. And she tried to play this game when I wasn't around. She's like, I didn't know what to do. I was scared because, or not scared, but like I was freaking out. I thought you'd be mad at me when you got home that I fucked up our farm. And I was like, I had to like, no, it's cool, relax.
You had to take a minute though.
He was like, it's cool. You didn't fuck up the farm though, right?
It's okay.
Like,
she told me this story of like, oh my god, when you were at work, there was a luau and they had a potluck and I had to bring something to the potluck and the store was closed and I didn't have any recipes. I didn't know how to cook anything. So like one of our plants like spawned a pepper. So I showed up at this luau with the pepper and on the way there were some grapes on the ground and I brought those two and I showed up. To the luau with a pepper and some grapes, and I was freaking out. It was like she was so stressed out, and like everybody brought like dishes and stuff, and she just ran up like with the pepper.
I found some grapes and a pepper.
I would like to see that in real life. Someone showing up to a potluck with a pepper and some grapes.
The funny thing is, like, if you came home from work and she was like freaking out about that for a good few minutes, you might sit there and be like, okay, did she really go to a potluck or was this Stardew Valley?
I can't quite figure it out. Something like that happens to us, and like we understand like what that kind of event is. We understand that you probably don't have to bring anything to the potluck, but to her, she doesn't play a lot of video games, and she was like, this is a big deal if I go to this potluck without a dish, you know? Yeah. And like, I just thought it was really so funny how she was like running around like freaking out trying to like find some food item to bring to this potluck, and it probably didn't even like change anything. I just thought it was super hilarious. And the thing is they started
nobody
like
liked
adding
her anyway.
Like, they started adding ingredients to like this giant soup or whatever at the luau, and they added her pepper, and she was like, oh my god, they actually used my pepper. And like the taste tester was like, eh, it wasn't that great this year, maybe better next year. And then like the mayor tried it, and she's like, and he was like, yeah, it wasn't that good. And like Leo was like, oh, it's all my fault.
My pepper now.
And it's funny too, because the first time we were like, because I told Malia, like, you need to pick a dude you want, I recommend the girl. She's like, no, I'm gonna marry a dude, and she got really frustrated when she found out she couldn't marry the mayor because she was like, I bet I get something if I choose to marry the mayor. She doesn't care about these people's personalities. It's absolutely horrible. But
Wait, so y'all? I assume y'all are playing one singular character.
We're playing one singular character. They're gonna introduce a multiplayer mode in the future. I don't know how it works. Like one person made this game.
Who knows
when it's gonna come out? But I mean, it's super addictive. We're obviously going to play more. Maybe I'll regale you with some smaller stories in the future. But I recommend, like, even if you've not played a Harvest Moon game, like, it's kind of hard to go back to those because those are, like, really, like, finicky and picky and kind of tedious in some respects. But, like, this game is, like, a an awesome entry point into this type of game, and I recommend, you know, any of you guys to play.
I think it's just a lot of fun. I'd be willing to bet at any point during this conversation, all three of us have seriously thought about playing this game, and then we're like,
it's kind of one of those games that's been on my list, but I'm afraid to start it.
It's super chill. It's super chill. Like, when you wake up in the morning, I'm just going to water my plants for half a day. It's kind of relaxing.
Is it one of those where, like, the game time runs?
Yeah.
So, like, if I don't for, like, a week and I go back, my farm's on fire.
Sorry. It's not like that. It's not
Raiders
like that.
Have taken my family.
It's not like that. You progress the time. In fact, if you want, you could just, like, sleep, you know, like, just water your crops and go to bed. Like
jump to the next
day. Like, at 10 a.m.
Would you eventually starve to death if you just never ate?
No. I don't even think you have to eat food. I mean, but you might go broke. I don't know.
Interesting.
It's a really, really fun.
Well, that sounds fantastic. Yeah. I would actually like to play that. Anyways, we'll check in with your Stardew Valley adventures next week. But right now, I think we should probably take a break.
Yeah.
And when we come back, we'll do Final Fantasy 15, the Platinum demo. We'll talk about that. There's some news related to that as well. Impressions wise, I do want to talk a little about Super Metroid, ever so slightly.
Postmortem.
Is there anything? What other games? What am I forgetting? There's so many games.
That's it for me.
If we're looking for stuff to talk about, I can mention Axiom Verge or.
Maybe we'll tie that into Super Metroid a little bit. Anyways, we'll take a quick break. We'll come back and we'll do the rest of our show.
Yeah.
Yeah. Hey, Brad.
Yo.
I hear you like the bump spot.
Eh. Okay, it's all right.
All right. This week, guys, we closed the poll on our Revival Club, our next episode of the Revival Club. If you remember, last month we did Dragon Quest VIII. We opened up a poll for our patrons to vote. For the next episode, the game to be featured in the next episode. And it looks like Psychonauts takes the win.
Love Psychonauts.
I've never played Psychonauts.
You should play it.
Well, maybe I will. So we'll be recording a new episode of the Revival Club this month. We are going to be opening up basically avenues for you to provide us with feedback, anecdotes, questions, thoughts, comments on your opinions of Psychonauts. So we'd love to get as much feedback on that as possible. If you are interested in giving us your feedback, please make sure and look at the show notes down for this podcast when you listen to it. If you're a patron, there will also be stuff on the Patreon activity feed letting you know how you can leave us comments before we record that. We'll probably be recording that middle of the month or so. We haven't really decided on a final date, but we should have that episode of the Rival Club before the end of the month, so we will make sure we get plenty of feedback before we do that. God damn it, Nolan. Next, I do want to mention we have a little bit of a weird situation, Brad.
What's that? What's weird? You're weird. Sorry.
because of reasons, we might be resubmitting our podcast to iTunes. This is mainly just so that we can, because we submitted our podcast to iTunes.
What does that mean, resubmitting?
Well, we submitted our podcast to God damn it, Chris Davis. We submitted our podcast to iTunes like 7 or 8 years ago, right? And we don't have a whole lot of control over it. So we're going to be resubmitting so that we can make sure we get control over that, so we can make changes, we can keep track of how we're doing and that kind of stuff easier. But the catch is, there's a catch, Brad. Do you know the catch is?
It's a bad one.
It's a bad catch.
All our reviews and ratings go away.
Yes.
And our standings on iTunes.
Yes, which means we're going to need your help when we do this. We're going to let everybody know before we do it. But when we do this, we would really, really, really appreciate it. Every single one of you who listen to this podcast would take a moment out of your day to go to iTunes, leave us a review.
We're really going to need your help, because if we want to control iTunes, y'all are going to have to help us out.
Yeah.
Because we're going to go back down to 0 ratings, 0 reviews.
But at the same time, you know, it'll be a nice surge of reviews. So we would really appreciate your help and just going on there and leaving us some reviews. And 4-star ratings or whatever, however many stars they offer.
Five stars.
Give us 5 stars out of 5. That'd be really great.
People still use iTunes, sure. They also discover podcasts on iTunes, and we're going to completely lose our standings on there.
So we're
going to need your help.
We'll definitely need your help. We will let everybody know before we do that, which will probably be sometime next week. So, of course, we will still continue to be posting the podcast on SoundCloud. That's not going to change. And possibly in the coming months, other avenues as well. So we're starting to really look into making some big pushes there, and we're going to need y'all's help to help us boost our rankings and whatnot. So keep your eyes peeled for that. Lastly, I do want to just mention that we made some changes to the format of the podcast this week. You know, like we did the 4Player Minute at the beginning of the show. We're also going to be doing a new version of the game we've been playing at the end of the show. Things like that. So we would appreciate your feedback. If you are listening to the show, please take a moment to drop by 4playernetwork.com. Leave a comment on the post. Let us know what you think. We're open to any and all suggestions, ideas, comments, things you like, things you don't like, whatever it may be. So please just take a moment to do that. We really appreciate any and all feedback.
Cool. Thanks, Nick. That's some really good info.
You're welcome. I think it's time to go back to the show, though. Let's talk about more video games.
I agree.
You gotta bump out, Brad.
Bump out.
God damn it.
Bubble, bubble, bump out.
Welcome back to the show, everybody. We still have a few games to talk about. Before we get into the big Final Fantasy 15 demo / news, I just wanted to quickly talk about Super Metroid. Oh my god. Brad, what are you doing?
Were you saving that for later?
No, it just rolled under the couch.
I didn't see
under
that.
Under the what? The couch?
The couch. I didn't see it under the couch earlier. I think he was storing that for a later date.
That's actually been sitting down there for a week.
It was aging.
Yeah. Let's get it out of my system, guys. I played Super Metroid.
Did you finish?
I finished.
Wow.
It only took me 3 sittings. and that last sitting was literally 15 minutes, 20 minutes.
Okay. What did y'all think of the ending? Like the story? The thing is, you encounter the baby Metroid in the second game. Dude. On the Game Boy. Mm-hmm. No one played that one. But it's cool, right?
The ending is so terrifying. Like, I was so... Like, they make you put up with a lot of shit to get to the final fight, and then the final fight itself really just kind of feels like a formality.
I think I beat that in my first try.
Yeah, I definitely did.
But that's what
it is easier than so cool. Most of the boss fights in that game.
But it's supposed to be a moment of empowerment.
But I mean, it's really fucking cool. Like when the baby Metroid, like fully grown, showed up at the end, I was like fucking terrified. Yeah. I was like, oh no, because I'd just been dealing with those like real Metroids,
and then it sits on my head.
Yeah, and it gets on top of you, and you're like, oh no, don't kill me! And then it starts like, and like injecting you with energy, and you're like, oh.
And then suddenly you have the rainbow
and then
laser.
You have that fucking rainbow beam that can just destroy anything. It's it's so hard.
That was pretty cool. I'll be totally honest. I wasn't really sure what was going on at first. I had to think about it for a second. I was like, what? And then I was like, oh yeah, the Metroid at the beginning.
The best part of the awful game, Metroid Other M, was that there's that like the beginning of that, and they used it in the promos. There is a CG version of like the ending to Super Metroid, and I kind of get teared up a little bit because it's such a fucking cool
Wait,
moment.
Did y'all play Other M?
Yeah, I finished.
I'm a Metroid
fan. I'll play the crappy ones. I don't care.
When did you do this? I've been talking to you about video games for years. I thought
back
you avoided that like the plague.
2010.
No, we were definitely podcasting when I beat that game.
Jesus. I remember David played it. I didn't know you did.
2010? 2011?
Holy crap.
Yeah. I'll show you that cutscene. Because it's shit all over Metroid. The baby, the baby, the baby. The baby. Oh! I fucking hate Other M.
What?
They turned... it. Don't get me fucking started on Other M.
Okay. Just breathe.
I finished Super Metroid.
But, yeah. That ending was cool. I like how... As soon as the boss dies and you're like, oh my god, I finally did it. Yeah. The game's just like, get the fuck out!
So everyone who watched knows I got really, really frustrated twice playing this game.
Dude.
And the second night I was really pissed off myself, mainly because I knew I was quitting a second time. And I was so close to the end. I was in the last hall before you go in to fight the final boss when I quit.
I kind of wanted to say something because... I wanted to tell you, no, the boss fight is not even really like a boss fight. Just try again. But I'm
so glad that I stopped in retrospect, because the state that I was in before that night, before I quit, I would not have been able to handle the area. I would have rage quit so hard, because I was already flustered. I was already pissed off. And that sequence, if you're not like, you know, they give you a lot of time to get out, but you are doing a lot of precision, like... Some of the most frustrating parts in this game for me were precision platform precision platforming related. Especially like there's one room is like filling up with lava and you're trying to jump up these like tiny little steps or whatever.
Yeah.
And I kept missing them, and when you miss you fall all the way to the bottom and you're being bombarded with damage because you're sitting in lava essentially.
The worst is like when there's like a lot of platforms and you're like, I'm gonna make this jump, but you like cut it short and you just start falling down. You're like, oh, I'm gonna land on a platform,
and you never do.
Keep going down and down and down. You're like, damn it, I should have moved.
That's what
like
I was always yelling about.
Starts dropping with Samus. Like,
yeah, it's amazing. So many times I ended up on the bottom rung or bottom level of a room just because I assumed that I was gonna land on another platform when I was falling,
or like,
and I never did.
Like I've gotten into bad ones where like I'll be falling down a long shaft like that, and I'm trying to hit a platform to,
and you keep missing everyone.
And I keep like zigging around them. Like I'm like, okay, go right. No, I missed. I go left. Oh god, I missed another one.
So every year when they do, or two times a year now when they do Awesome Games Done Quick, the biggest donation driver that they bring in is for the vote. Like you put your donations towards save the animals or kill the animals, and that determines whatever gets raises the most money determines what the speedrunner will do at the end of Super Metroid, whether they go that extra step to save the animals or let them die.
But I did not know that was even a thing. Like I didn't know anything about that until like I'm watching the final cutscene where the gunship's flying away and Zebus explodes. It's just like, and they're like, did he save the animals? And I'm like, I didn't save anything.
Like, I saved myself.
Were there animals to
no
save?
No one saves them on their first playthrough of Super Metroid. Yeah.
I saved myself.
But it's
that's
the
all
animals
that
teach you how to do like the wall jumping and the super jump and all that.
And
shit,
I thank
right?
them for their donation.
Their service was well accepted.
Exactly.
I'm sorry.
Exactly.
They will. Forgotten probably.
I always hear Chris Davis snapping at my dogs from the other room. I wonder what they're
really
doing out there.
Dogs.
Are you keeping them off my couch? Because if so, thanks.
He's keeping them away from his burrito.
Anything y'all want to... I mean, Brad, I finished Super Metroid. Are you happy?
No, I am. I mean,
are you
I
fucking
feel
happy?
Bad.
I'm fucking
I'm hoping
happy.
At the end of the day, like with Link to the Past, you can at least respect it as a game that came out
Dude,
in 1994.
I'm glad that I'm glad I can officially say that I've played these games.
Yeah, I mean, you've now played a 2D Metroid.
You know,
I this is kind of why I was maybe suggesting doing Zero Mission. Because it's shorter, and it's easier, but it's not that iconic one, you know? And you know, part of Project M is the nostalgia factor, you know? And
It was a little bit longer than we expected.
I feel like more so than with like other older games that we've gone back and revisited for the fuck of it. Like, for instance, Final Fantasy Tactics. I liked Final Fantasy Tactics. I enjoyed it. I had a fun time with it. But by the time I finished it, I was like, okay, that's off the bucket list.
Yeah.
I could kind of just like set it aside. Even if there hadn't been like a bucket list like nostalgia component to wanting to have completed Super Metroid, I'm so glad I played it because I fucking like really, really, really got into it. Like I really liked it.
It opens the doors.
It was just a fun game. Like,
now I will say this: I played Metroid Prime. That was my first Metroid game I ever played, and I loved Metroid Prime. And that is still a series I fully intend to go back and finish, like that trilogy. I'm probably going to take a little bit of a break before attempting that again, just because I need to cool off a little bit from playing a Metroid game. But I'm definitely glad I played Super Metroid.
How crazy is it to you guys that Super Metroid came out, set the world on fire, well, people who had Super Nintendos, and there was not another Metroid game until Metroid Prime?
That is pretty crazy.
Ridiculous. That's crazy, right?
See, I didn't like, realize how, that. Like, I never thought about that.
I mean,
that's why Symphony of the Night was such this revelation, because it's like, oh my god, this is like Super Metroid.
Dude,
you know?
And then playing Symphony of the Night and looking back on Super Metroid, it kind of like, it makes it feel a little flatter than it did when we were like actually playing it. I was like, that was really fun. There's a lot of exploration and puzzle solving, but like, can you imagine a Super Metroid game where you actually have like a full like RPG system like Castlevania, like where you have like different equipment, like different pieces of armor that you're finding and like switching out? That's one of the reasons why I think Axiom Verge is so fucking cool, because it's like Metroid, but you actually have like this whole array of like different weapons and different equipment that do different things. Like it just adds a little bit more to it, you know? It's still not quite on that like that full RPG spectrum, but god damn it, like that, why was that allowed to happen?
Metroid Prime also came out the same day as Metroid Fusion, for the.
So you got it. We got it. Oh, yeah. So there was there was Super Metroid, and then it was
like it's like
is Fusion good?
Yeah,
Fusion? Yeah, Fusion's good. Yeah,
it's good. I mean, all the Metroid, Other M sucks.
Yeah, Other M's pretty much the only Metroid mission. You should definitely avoid.
I mean, I think it's hard to go back to the original Metroid or Metroid 2. Mm-hmm. I think it's hard to go back to those. But Super Metroid on, I mean, they're all good games in their own ways, besides Other M. Which is, you know, it's not a terrible game, but the way they treat the character of Samus is just an abomination. It's fucking atrocious.
All right, I'm not going to ask. I kind of want to, but I'm not going to.
Is Other M where the sexy Samus suit came from?
No, that was. It is.
Is that Fusion? Wait, which
one? Zero suit. I believe officially Zero Suit started with Zero Mission.
Yeah.
Oh, Zero Mission.
But
I
think she may have had it in. Yeah, I don't know.
I know the Zero suit is divisive, I guess, but. I don't know. I love the character design, whether she's Zero Suit Samus or
Zero Suit or not. Like awesome. It is not like Other M, where she's like 5 foot tall all of a sudden, and five foot tall. And men.
Her little fucking like that pixie cut thing or whatever. Not pixie cut, like a fucking bob or whatever she has. It's, yeah.
All right, we said we're not gonna get Brad started. Yeah.
Brad's having a hard time.
Yeah. Is there anything you want to say about Axiom Verge? I mean, all right.
I mean, I played like 6 hours of it. It is definitely a Metroid clone. Like, it is Metroid through and through. I don't really understand what's going on yet story-wise. What is happening is, like, really crazy. The story seems to be pretty interesting. I kind of like, too, how... it seems to have something to do with like artificial intelligence. Like there's these like AIs that you're like working with, but I don't know if I'm working with them. Again, I haven't gotten far enough for it to really like start opening up. But there are these neat little moments where like the first time you die and you go back to a save point. Like when he comes out, he's like, "What the fuck just happened?" And they're like, "Oh, you died, and we used your how would you say this like mind machines to remake you." And he's sitting there for a second, just like, "Oh my god, am I even me anymore?" Like he's having a little like existential crisis in the middle of this whole thing. And they're like, "Yeah, it's fine. Just go, get back. Like keep shooting things. Like
sweet.
Like it's really cool." But the level of progression, like the upgrades and everything, are really cool.
That's on Vita weapons, too, right?
Yeah. Or it's coming to
Vita. It's coming to Vita.
Yeah. Maybe I'll just wait for the Vita version.
It might be this month. But,
who am I kidding? I'm not going to have time to play this anytime soon.
But it's really interesting. It's really good. And it's, like, for me, jumping back and forth between Super Metroid and Symphony of the Night, like, looking for something else to kind of, like, scratch that itch is perfect. Like,
cool.
It fit right in there.
Cool. All right. Let's talk about it.
Kingdom Hearts Platinum Demo.
Yeah.
God, we didn't even get to talk about, like, I didn't even get to say the actual name of the game before someone dropped the Kingdom Hearts joke.
Wait, it's called Platinum Demo?
To be fair, yeah. Versus 13 was a Final Fantasy 13 spinoff made by the Kingdom Hearts team.
Sure. Sure it was.
To be fair.
I mean, I'm not discrediting the joke. I mean, it is very much channeling Kingdom Hearts in a lot of ways.
You have a squeaky
happen to really like Kingdom Hearts, so I don't find... You know what thought I was having while playing this demo?
Huh.
This is going to dovetail beautifully with Kingdom Hearts. Like, yeah. When Kingdom Hearts 3 comes out, like, these characters and this tone would, like, already, like, perfectly blend in with the world they've already created in Kingdom Hearts.
Is anyone making Kingdom Hearts jokes because it looks like Kingdom Hearts?
You play as Noxus.
Look at your little. It's a squeaky hammer. Like, it makes a squeak noise.
Yeah, you play. You're having a dream.
Yeah.
And play as the young version of yourself,
dude,
of the main character.
Kingdom Hearts 3 looks like this.
Right?
That would be
right?
Cool.
Dude, Kingdom Hearts 3 looks incredible.
I don't follow this shit.
Oh, dude, if you haven't seen Kingdom Hearts 3 in footage and act, you should check it out. It looks fucking incredible. But this very much is channeling Kingdom Hearts in a lot of ways. So, like, you play as a young character. You play as a young version of the main character of the game. He's having a dream. He's running around this Travers very... Town. He's running around an area that's, I guess, reminiscent. Like, but it is a dream, so you start out in like this outdoor like foresty forest area, and then you like jump into a pond, and you come out the other side into like a water bowl, and you're in this giant room that
it's like Alice in Wonderland when she eats the cookie and she shrinks.
Yeah, so you
or
feel
like in Kingdom Hearts in Wonderland where you shrink.
Yeah. Yeah, and then you turn into fucking animals. I turned into this alligator. Yeah. I ran around as this alligator
like a gator dragon.
Yeah,
dude. When you shrink and you're in the little world, Crispy, with you can turn into a car and drive around.
Yeah. What?
Like you don't get in the car, you turn into the car.
Is it an Audi?
No, it's like a fruit truck.
There's also a car too. Did you not get the car?
It's like a food cart.
There's like a farm truck and there's a car that's really zippy that you can transform into. Yeah.
That room you're driving around, there's like these giant like toy blocks, and you can like
they when you were a kid, like, the wooden blocks, and some were cylinders, and some were like the arch and stuff, and you would build. Yeah. There's those, and you can just run into them with a car, and they collapse, and like it's pretty fun.
Let's be honest. This demo was purely meant. It's designed in such a way to show you the lighting engine, the physics engine. This is purely a tech demo.
Yeah.
So there's not that much gameplay.
I mean, there's a tech demo followed by a combat demo.
Mm-hmm.
Like literally, this demo like dovetails into like an actual like combat boss.
It's the area we've seen a lot where Noctis is fighting the behemoth.
And I'll get to it.
But instead, you fight this giant iron guy.
I kind of run through this area so I can get straight to that combat sequence because literally like you're running around this world collecting orbs that you can use to unlock these switches that let you change like the time of day so you can see how the lighting engine works. The weather. One will even give you like gifts that give you like extra like a new weapon or a spell. Like there was one I think it was a meteor.
Meteor rain. Yeah.
Which is cool because like when you use it, it makes all these like orbs, these like glowing orange orbs, just like fall. But they sound like they're made of like.
I was watching you play. They're like little bouncy balls. You seemed way more excited about
that. Dude, I think it was a really
that.
Cool effect. It's because it's fucking OP as shit, for one thing. As soon as you throw it, like, everything dies.
This really is just showing you, like, the different particle kinds of effects. The particle effects.
I'm still unclear on something, though.
What's up?
Like, when you say it's a tech demo, that sounds kind of like bare bones.
It is.
Like, you can beat this demo in, like, 20 minutes.
It's like 20 minutes.
Yeah.
You can't.
So it's not like that last demo they put out where it was just, like, no. Player.
Like, I played this for an hour, but I stretched it.
Yeah.
I was doing everything
and taking
my time.
When I recorded this footage, I rushed through it in, like, 15 minutes.
Yeah, you can get through it really quick.
And we'll get to the combat here in a second. I think it's a nice way of demoing the tech, because this is not going to be part of the actual game.
Correct.
This is literally just a thing to show you how certain things work.
It shows like the day-night cycle. It shows, you know, the light engine. The whole time during this demo, Carbuncle is your old friend. He finds you. He doesn't talk. He texts.
Oh, you mean Red Rocket.
Okay, I guess so. He texts you.
He texts?
When you first see him, he drops a phone in front of you, and then a text message pops up, and he's like, hey,
I have no idea how he's texting. Like, yeah. I don't
He's
really...
magical.
Yes, I've actually named my Carbuncle Red Rocket, because at the end of the...
I named mine Dick Butt.
At the end of the demo, you get to name your Carbuncle character, because I'm assuming he carries over into the actual
game. If you
beat
this demo when you play Final Fantasy 15, it will unlock Carbuncle in Final
Fantasy
15.
And he keeps the name you gave him.
What the fuck
I'm running around as like a giraffe.
Giraffe slash elk. Like elk, yeah.
With tiger stripes.
Yeah.
Yeah, so...
Say rat! Say rat!
So the thing I do want to point out is... One thing that still has me a little concerned, I have some problems with the camera in this game. And I think a lot of that stems from the fact that this is a, an action RPG in terms of, like, the camera. You can manipulate the camera in battle when you're running around. And you have, like, a lot of your chances of success in a fight are going to be dictated specifically by how well you control the camera. And
you do really need to focus. You need to lock on.
Yeah.
You need to make sure you're locking on.
And locking
on
is not like switching between characters. Is not very responsive.
Yeah. It's.
I'm hoping they tighten some of that stuff up a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
Does it feel improved from?
The thing is,
the first demo.
The first demo, it's hard to gauge because they're demoing totally different things.
So you do realize that they updated that first demo with new controls.
You can
and
go
stuff,
back and
so
play
you
it.
Can go back and play it updated.
I haven't done that yet.
Neither have I.
I'd like to.
Yeah.
But like it's comparing these would be like comparing apples
so,
to oranges.
So to that regard, like Nick said, at the end of this demo, you do play as an adult Noxus fighting, you know, in actual combat, like how you would when you play the game. The only thing is, you're fighting one enemy in a big open area.
But you can respawn as many times as you want, and you get stronger the second time you respawn.
Correct. Every time you respawn, every time you fight him again, he gets stronger.
I don't think he does. To an extent. He says, because when you first fight him, he's level 3, uh-huh. and then when you respawn him, he's level 15, and I think he's 15 every
I think
time.
He, someone said he goes up to 30. I think. I don't know.
Maybe he does.
Don't quote me. Fuck you. But one of the cool things about fighting him is I was able to try different mechanics. I was able to not just do like the sword, but you have different swords. I was able to, you get like a shield that you can use and you can, did you ever like do a parry and then counter?
Yes.
Once. Yeah. So like, that's really cool that you can actually like, I think it's really improved.
So I think the combat, especially at this point when we still are kind of unsure as to how it's going, like it's easy to look at this fight and be like, that was a really cool fight, but how is this going to translate to other encounters in the game, whatnot? And I think a lot of people, especially maybe people who are more used to like really tight combat systems, especially I can maybe see like Dark Souls fans maybe being a little put off by it, because
this is definitely not that style of game
though. No, it's not, but like the combat does really expect you to be like on point with dodging there's even a parrying system you can parry in this game. Which I think, you know, is probably not as tight or refined as something in, like Dark Souls or Bloodborne, so...
But I also, in that regard, if you get hit by an attack from an enemy because you messed up a parry in this, you're not gonna fuck... It's not game over.
No, I mean...
But in a Souls game, it could be. That could be your fucking death.
Yeah, but, like, when I was trying to, like, master the dodging, like, I was having a hard time. And you'll say, you know... The first time I played it, I fought the Iron Giant like 5 or 6 times, and by the end of it, I was doing really well. And then I put it down, and I came back to record this footage, and I was kind of having to try and get used to the dodging again, and I was fucking it up. So I fuck up the dodges quite a bit in this fight here.
You didn't just stun lock him?
Because
you can warp. Well, you have your warp ability.
Which, by the way, I spent too much time in this fight you're about to watch trying to use the warp ability from the get-go, but I didn't realize they actually tell you how to use that.
Yeah, you have
at,
to.
Like, halfway through the fight, so I couldn't even use it at the beginning.
The first time you fight him, it locks a lot of stuff. The second time, it unlocks everything from the very beginning. So yeah, you don't have your warp ability, but yeah, you can warp to like the top of that building right there.
Yeah, which I'm gonna
do. And do a warp strike, and every single time you do it, it will stun lock.
Yeah,
him.
I did that a lot.
Okay.
So like, I spent a lot of time trying to do it right here, like at the early points in the fight, but you can't do it until
you,
like,
I see you looking
for it. So I'm like looking
it.
Up, trying to lock. I was like, why isn't it working? But it happens like later in the fight. So I was fucking up quite a bit early on in this fight. But one thing I will say, like, I think I like. Say what you will about how tight it is or how maybe quirky it is. Like, I think this combat's really fun. And I think there's gonna be a lot of potential for some really awesome fights, like really cinematic.
Oh, definitely.
Fights.
Especially in the Final Fantasy universe, because you know you saw earlier you're fighting smaller enemies, and in the demo we played before you fought the behemoth, and so that's one of the things I'm excited about. Is in previous Final Fantasy games, there's been a lot of, you know, you go into like.
Fucking Carbuncle's trying to text me in the middle of this.
Just the scale of enemies, you know, and we did see it in the episode Disky or whatever.
Yeah.
But that's one of the things I really am excited for, is just, you know, just these enemies being out in the world and just encountering them randomly. And
see, I was trying to dodge there and I fucked it up.
It's all good.
But like when you actually do dodge, it feels so cool.
It does that
like,
kind of slow down. Because
when you dodge, you
warp a little bit.
Warp a little bit, like you kind of. Go transparent, and like you, like sometimes they'll swing their sword and you like dodge right at the right moment and the sword like goes right through you, but it has this like really cool particle effect when it does, which I think is pretty awesome feeling.
And you can see like one of like the limit break style moves in this demo as well.
Did you ever do the move like he actually like he'll do like a big swing and like bring that sword down and you can actually like block it?
Yeah, you can block that attack. Yeah, and like he has that giant sword and your tiny sword blocks it, and then you can knock it off and then attack him. Yeah.
Yeah.
If you get the block at the right time, yeah. And then so this is, I think that's when Carbuncle, was that when he, no, that's when he gave,
I think that was Carbuncle just healing me because I was fucking up.
Yeah. Well, you can get this limit break.
Yeah, I do
where
that.
It's the thing where like all of a sudden every time you slash, like swords start
warping.
Here we go.
Now I can finally start zipping around everywhere.
Yeah, doing the
warp
strike.
I was like, son of a bitch, I wasted way too much time trying to do that. But this is a real, what I'm wondering is this mechanic going to be like somehow shoehorn into like every fight in the game?
I don't think so, because you know
this is crazy.
Like, we did see in episode of Sky, you know, you weren't always near big buildings you could warp to.
Yeah.
Like, sometimes you're out in the middle of nowhere, you're not gonna be able to do this.
Like, this stuff is cool.
Yeah, you can warp all the way up to the fucking top of the building, and then
are they predetermined points?
Yes.
Yes, but you can also like. You can start, so right here, I'm trying to go down and get this shield that's on this balcony, which is actually a secret, but you can, like, if you don't lock onto something, you can warp in directions like that, so you can, like, precision, like, try and get your way over to the balcony and grab the secret item, which is cool. But if you're locking onto something and you want to, like, latch onto a side, yes, there's predetermined lock-on points. But, like, that stuff's really cool, and, like, for this particular fight, it felt really awesome. I'm just wondering if that's really going to be something that's incorporated into, like, every boss fight.
I think it's
going to
depend on where you are in the world. I think there's going to be cityscapes like this where you can do a whole lot more warping, and there's probably going to be a whole lot more areas where there's not, you don't have that ability. I mean, do you think, we did see some in a little bit less about the demo, more about the Final Fantasy Uncovered, Undisclosed.
That's, I guess we're going to kind of...
Yeah.
Talk about that as well.
In the trailer, they showed fucking, like the boat.
Yeah.
You're just gonna be like, do you think you might be fighting, like, in the water? I don't know if that's gonna actually happen. I mean, I was thinking back to something like Final Fantasy X, when you're on top of the airship and you're fighting the flying, like, whatever creature. You know, I don't know.
Dude, the scope of this game is pretty fucking crazy looking.
I would hope so after 10 years.
Yeah.
I would hope that they maybe improved on the game a little bit.
Brad, you've been a little quiet over there. You're making me nervous. What are you thinking? I know you have thoughts.
Why? I mean, I just didn't play it. I downloaded it, but I didn't play it.
Oh.
I mean, it's worth checking out.
I wasn't too keen on that last demo.
One thing I do want to do before the next show, I'm going to go play that updated version of that demo, because they have pushed some patches through to that demo. Mm-hmm. So, you know, I think it's cool. They're kind of giving people, like, it's almost like giving them kind of a progress report and showing what kind of things they're doing.
I really like that they did put out that demo. They're like, look, this is what we got. Play it, give us your feedback. Oh, you didn't like this? We'll fix it.
Yeah.
So when the game comes out, we'll have fixed the problems that you had with the game. And to make it better.
Yeah.
I actually do appreciate that to an extent, because especially a game fucking 10 years in the making, I hope it's pretty good when it comes out.
Yeah, I'm still, I guess from what we've seen, it does look like it's going to be pretty open, but obviously after playing Final Fantasy 13, part of me is still a little worried it's going to be a little too linear, because those first areas in this demo were pretty damn linear, but again...
You know why I think it's going to be big.
Because of the driving?
Because you have a bat wing.
Oh, Crispy, what'd you think about that?
What?
The bat wing.
He didn't see the bat wing?
We showed him the gif of it. Your car transformed.
Oh, the car turning into... Okay, I'm sorry. I also watched Pee-wee's Big Holiday the other day, and there's a car that does the exact same thing in that movie.
Well, you watched... I watched it too.
I got confused for a second. But yeah, oh my god, you're right. What the fuck?
And so that was... We kind of talked about that.
Can you just use that anywhere?
That's the
thing
we're
curious
about.
In the open world, it seems like.
It does seem like you can just transform at any point. That's not confirmed. We don't know that.
Now, what I think is really funny is that, like, you know, a few months ago they were talking about, there was discussions about whether or not there was even going to be air travel in this game at all.
Yeah.
Like, whether there would even be airships featured. And they were like, we're currently looking into our options. And I'm wondering if this was their compromise.
Maybe,
like,
yeah.
Let's just turn the car into an air vehicle. Done.
Yeah.
Which, you know, part of me is really excited about that. Part of me is also kind of bummed because, you know, some of my favorite, like, Final Fantasy memories are, like, Final Fantasy VIII with Ragnarok. And,
yeah.
Like, flying that thing around the open world was awesome. And Final Fantasy IX had one, too. And, you know, it's just the Highwind and VII. Like, those were some of the most awesome...
Yeah,
I love the audio.
And to that regard, I could see that
13
being...
13 didn't have one.
I could see that being difficult in this style of game.
10 had one. It just wasn't flying, but
you didn't
have
a menu. Yeah, it was a menu you could go to.
Like,
and that's the thing.
Couldn't you go onto the ship? You just couldn't.
You could, you could run around, but you couldn't
go
do anything.
The ship, it didn't fly anywhere.
Yeah. But that's the thing with this style of game. And it's kind of like the more 3D ones of more recent, of late, that's harder to do because in those older games, they just fucking, it was a ship on like a tiny globe that you would fly around.
Yeah.
And that, I don't know if that would fly nowadays to that extent.
But then again, the thing, I mean, that's what kind of blew my mind about like Xenoblade X.
Yeah.
Because you could just fly around this big open world and you don't see that in modern JRPGs.
Now,
so if this game can pull that off, I'm a little suspect that the areas might not be connected in such a seamless way.
Yeah.
Like, I don't think you could just fly over those mountains, but hey, I mean, Xenoblade did it, and that was on a Wii U, so who knows?
So one thing I feel it's crazy saying this because I think, you know, obviously we want something more akin to like Xenoblade X, where you do have that freedom, you do have that huge open world, but like part of me is thinking back to when I played Ni No Kuni and like then thinking about when I played Final Fantasy IX, which is my personal favorite Final Fantasy, which was kind of like the same style of open world as Ni No Kuni. Mm-hmm. And I'm like, Jesus Christ, I would love to see them go back to like more traditional Final Fantasy and do an open world like Ni No Kuni, where it's kind of like a stylized map and you're running around, like your sprites running around on the, like,
I don't see them doing that with this game.
Not with this one, for sure.
I could see them maybe in the future doing a game like that. This game, I don't see them doing it.
Oh, yeah. No, it's definitely not in this game. It's just, it seems to me like, you know, because when nine happened, it was very much that kind of thing. It was like, hey, we're going back to like classic Final Fantasy, and that was their thing. And we were like, oh crap, that's cool. Like, I'm kind of hoping they do that.
Play
again.
Bravely Default.
Yeah,
I have played Bravely Default.
But so other news and like that Final Fantasy press event, they announced a lot of stuff we didn't know about. Like they're doing a Final Fantasy 15 anime.
And
they're doing a series. The first episode's out, I heard
it's not bad.
I haven't seen it yet.
Wait, who was it that was going to be in the movie they're doing?
There's three big people in the movie.
Yeah.
Lena Headey.
Headey. Cersei.
Headey Lamarr. Cersei Lannister. That's what I was thinking. Yeah, so Cersei Lannister.
Headley.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking. And that was on TV the other day. Sean Bean.
Oh, he's going to die.
Yeah.
That's what we were saying.
He's going to die.
That's what
we were
saying.
And
Aaron Paul. Or like the
three. Oh, yeah, I remember people talking about that. That's fucking weird.
It's weird. But the thing is, I was watching the press conference.
No, the weird thing is that they're voicing characters in the movie that are also in the game that are voiced by different people.
Yeah. Yeah, anyway.
Really?
Yeah.
Yeah.
They couldn't get them for the whole thing?
Well, I mean, imagine how much it would cost to pay Lena Headey to do a voice for like a 50-hour game.
Why did they get him for the movie?
I don't know.
Because
it's a two-hour movie.
Well, that's the thing, as we kind of talked about, is, an actor, a good actor, does not equal a good voice actor.
No, but let's give him a fair shake before we tell him they're going to be bad. Like, they could be good.
So, but yeah, once again, we didn't mention it, but they are doing a Final Fantasy 15 movie a la
Kingsglaive,
a la Advent Children style.
Which, I'll be honest, I'm actually pretty excited for it because that looked crazy.
It looks good.
Wait a minute, one more time. Aaron Paul, Sean Bean.
Sean Bean.
You've already forgotten because he already died in your mind.
Yeah, he already died.
Yep. it's a movie, and you know both the anime and the movie are prequels to the game. Like Kingsglaive is events that take place during the game, but not a right.
I think it actually takes place before the game, but I could be wrong.
I can't.
It focuses around Noctis's father.
Correct.
And his Kingsguard, which
but
is
you don't
King's
play
Cliff.
As Noctis's father in the game.
No, you play as Noctis.
I know, you go off somewhere else, and I think you're right.
It might be. Yeah,
I think it's stuff that's going on in at the same time. It's just different parts of the world.
Sean Bean playing.
He's the king. Yes.
Yeah.
Cool.
Yeah.
Lena Headey is playing Luna, which is the love interest of
Noctis's love interest.
Aaron Paul is Rex.
He's the main guy. He's the main guy in the Kingsglaive. He is the head of the king's like royal soldiers.
Where does this fall in the wider world of like Final Fantasy 13 and Final Fantasy Type Zero? Like, is this all?
Well, this is totally. I mean,
like, does this
I don't
all
know.
Happen after all those games?
Well, I mean, every Final Fantasy is independent.
Well, those are all the same world. The 13 games, Type
they
Zero,
were.
And this are all still, from what I understand, the same world.
I think they've
might be some loose ties.
I think they're trying to.
I think they've probably went back and did some talking about it, but I don't think they're acknowledging that this takes place in the same universe.
Is there a Falci or a Lucy? No. I thought I heard something about a something C.
I think originally there was, but
yeah,
I think they definitely distanced that.
At the beginning, this was supposed to take place in the same universe as Final Fantasy 13.
Yeah.
I think since this became Final Fantasy 15, I think they've gone back and done some rewrites and some changes.
They've had 10 years.
Names. Like, I feel like at the end of the day, while you can definitely see the inspiration of 13 here, or like how it had its roots in 13, I feel like this is still going to feel like a completely separate entry in the franchise, I think. I hope.
I agree. The other thing I wanted to bring up that they brought up is, you know, a big popular thing with Final Fantasy games are the mini games like Blitzball and Triple Triad. Mm-hmm. And in Final Fantasy 15, they are going to have Justice Monsters 5,
which is a pinball game.
But,
now,
I saw that. Them all like hanging around the pinball machine. You actually like go, a bunch
you,
of toughs.
You go yeah. into the diners and they have yeah. the pinball machines.
That's awesome.
You laugh, Nolan, but I'm putting money down right now. In 7 or 8 months, pinball. You're going to be addicted to the pinball game.
Dude, if it's... Cool.
If it's not just going to be pinball.
If it's like space pinball, on the fucking only game installed on like original, like Windows.
I'm just going to give them the benefit of the doubt for a second. When has Square Enix made a Final Fantasy minigame that wasn't crazy addicting?
The 1 and 9 kind of sucked.
Yeah, the card game in 9 was not good.
Maybe it wasn't as good as Triple Triad, but it was still good.
Chocobo Racing can suck a ball. Yeah,
it was also fucking amazing.
What was the minigame in 13?
Did they even have a minigame in 13?
What was in 10?
10 was Blitzball.
I was thinking 12. Sorry, 12.
Did they even have one in 12? Because 12 was such a departure for the series in general. I feel like maybe...
12 was for grown-ups.
Oh, fuck.
Dude, Faust... not to correct you, but I'm looking at this right here. It says Final Fantasy 13, 1, 2, and 3, Final Fantasy Type-0, and Final Fantasy 15, and Final Fantasy...
No, it was.
Agito are all in the...
Yeah, no, it was. It started out as that.
Which share a common mythos, right? Yeah. Which are all the same.
Now, you know what makes me think this may not be the same universe is because...
It sounds like it's the same universe.
It was.
It was designed as the same universe.
They wrote it out.
I feel like they're writing it out.
It's still... listed.
You can keep if you want to keep going on feeling.
I think that's interesting though. If it's like these are completely disparate time periods in the same world.
The thing is, like, what was weird about Final Fantasy 13, which I really hated, was there's like summons have always been a huge thing with Final Fantasy.
Yeah,
summons in Final Fantasy 13 were like tied to specific characters, and they were all like vehicles, or they were basically like Transformers. And like the summons in this game, Sheeple, like we already seen Carbuncle.
We've seen Carbuncle. We've seen
Leviathan, Titan.
We've seen Leviathan.
Ramu.
Ramu was in the demo.
Yeah.
This new information we've seen Titan.
Yeah.
Which looks fucking amazing because it's a giant fucking Titan that runs up and like scoops you up
and then slams you into the ground.
In the Platinum demo, we did see Leviathan flying in the background,
and they all look more like traditional Final Fantasy summons, which is what I've always loved the summons in Final Fantasy which is one of the biggest fucking disappointments was 13 was how they handled summons. Hated it with the fiery passion. So like the fact that they're not Transformers anymore makes me feel like, and they haven't said the word Lassie since it changed to Final Fantasy 15. Like,
show me Knights of the Round in this engine.
I mean, it
Knights of the Round hasn't been a thing since 7.
Yeah,
but hey. Anyways, any other thoughts? I'm pretty excited. There's other things that dropped during this.
Nothing big.
Release date. It's coming out this year, September 30th. The Florence and the Machine thing. Now
I might be on vacation. I mean, on my honeymoon. Fuck.
You know, so they had the whole Florence and the Machine
thing.
Stand by me. And at first, I was like, "What is happening?" But the more I listened to that, I'm like, "That was pretty good." I like that trailer. Like,
the original song is good. That cover was kind of whack.
Whatever. We have a long history of disagreeing on Final Fantasy trailers, so whatever.
Oh yeah, you liked My Hands.
I do like that trailer.
Did y'all hear the news that came out today?
No.
So with the release of the game, they announced an Ultimate Collector's Edition bundle. It comes with statues and books and music and all this other shit.
Fuck.
And of course, people bought them and immediately started selling them on eBay like $600, $700. And Square Enix came out today saying they were going to harshly and strictly come down on those people selling those.
What does that even mean?
How?
They listed a bunch of different ways, you know, tracking credit card information.
It still makes you think twice IPs about doing it.
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah. They're pretty upset about people.
If you really want to, maybe I'll buy yours.
I did buy one. I didn't think it was gonna go through. I'm debating on if I want to just hold on to it for like a year. Because, you know, like bundles always still go for a lot. You know, a couple of years down the line, if you have a sealed thing, they fucking go for a lot of money.
If the game's
good. Until they re-release it.
That's the thing.
I mean, game's good. That's the thing. What if the game's... I mean, like, how would you feel if you bought like a vanilla statue or something because you were pumped for 13? It'd be so fucking lame.
I don't know.
Why'd you bring her up?
Because
she's like secretly the main character. That stupid fucking.
Which is why 13-2 and Lightning Returns are the best parts of that series.
You know what? I've never played those, but I fucking believe you. Fuck Final Fantasy 13.
But yeah,
you could put a hat on a chocobo in 13-2. I heard.
Yes. Dude, 13-2 and Lightning Returns, like...
Were you the only person who
finished that? We didn't talk about that. Yeah, he is. In 15, you can whistle and, like, summon a chocobo.
Yep.
Which is pretty fucking awesome. And you can drift.
Oh, they can fucking drift.
Drifting chocobos.
Chocobo drifting. I can't wait.
Nier did it first.
I don't know. Nier did it first.
When you turn sharply, the chocobo will slide and drift.
Wait. Square Enix did make Nier. Maybe they just like ripped that out of Nier with the boar drifting.
The boar drifting, like, they got chocobo drifting.
And you know what?
You can like jump off cliffs and the chocobo can flutter and like go like distances. I'm sure that might be used for like finding secrets and stuff. And
why is that not? Why didn't they?
Why didn't they include that in the demo?
Like why was the demo so dumb?
I mean, they probably just didn't want to show off everything. Wait, they wanted to keep some stuff.
Yeah, like why?
Dude, the platinum demo is a tech demo.
I know, but why didn't they just like release another demo?
They've already done that.
Why didn't they just do another one?
Brad, how many games release demos as big as Episode to Sky anyway?
I know, but I'm saying if they're going to spend the time, do you want to know why?
Because they're spending their money in other things at this point.
To
be honest, that demo, the platinum demo, probably did not cost much to make.
Yeah,
they probably have all the assets already done, ready to go. It was just like, let's put together a small group of people to like throw these assets together in a certain order and
then pay Sony whatever it costs to upload shit, right?
Yeah.
What'd you do? So that's Final Fantasy 15. I'm actually pretty excited about it.
I still have absolutely no idea how to feel about this game.
Maybe you should play the demo, one of two demos.
Maybe play the Deuce Guy one, though.
Yeah, play
first.
The Deuce Guy
first. I did play that.
Oh, okay.
When it first came out. Yeah. I would be
interested before the next podcast for all of us to go back and play the updated demo. I'm considering doing
this guy. Episode this guy.
All right. What else we have? I did want to mention briefly, this is interesting. We've been talking about this for years. God of War. Remember that franchise? God of War, one of Sony's biggest selling franchises. Rumor has it, and this the website that broke the news or broke the rumor on this is also known for breaking other rumors that have proven to be true. Oh God, are we fucking up the audio here?
Just keep talking, Nick.
Sorry.
You're the only one who's on.
So they've pretty much ran the Greek mythology thing through the ground at this point, because they've done, how many games have we done now? Four games. He's killed just about every Greek god you can think of. There's really not enough gods left to make another full God of War game. So rumor has it now, and there's actually concept art which features a character that looks a lot like Kratos. It looks like they're going to be tackling Norse mythology.
Of course they are.
But we've been saying for years, like if they were to go and do a sequel to God of War,
something very different. Yeah, yeah.
But I just wish it wasn't Kratos.
Like, does that even make sense?
Eh.
I'm not an expert on like mythology, but do all those exist? Like, are they?
No, they're not in the same. No,
they feel like they're different universes.
But
right?
Who cares?
Yeah.
They're all false gods.
Yeah, they're all false gods, Nick.
Okay, maybe that. Okay,
there's only one god, ma'am. And I'm pretty sure he doesn't dress like that.
Like, how crazy? Like, what, I really if, what if they made a game with that just had Kratos, like, slowly ripping the head off of Jesus? Like, like, there's people out there's, there
you're who mashing, believe you're mashing Kratos, on square as Kratos is like, pulling Kratos his is, jaw apart.
Kratos I mean, is a Roman soldier nailing Jesus to a cross.
I, that's the thing. There's people out there who believe in Norse mythology, who believe in Greek mythology. There's people out there who believe that.
Oh my god. Probably not nearly as many. Yeah. I'm going to say that.
They okay, should do, sure. They should do a game about a Kratos who's atheist. He doesn't do anything. He just sits at home and is mad.
I'm just saying. No, it's like Assassin's Creed. It's coming.
And then you have to it's wait out, you have to wait outside the tomb for Jesus to come back to life and then kill him oh again. My god. Right? Oh my god. Is that how that works?
Did they spend all these years before switching off of Greek mythology to make sure that no one really dude, cared like, about Norse
like,
gods?
Everyone, like, everyone's been saying, oh, dude, Norse gods... God's God of War forever. Like, everybody... It's the same thing with people who are like, they should do a Victorian London Assassin's Creed. Like, everybody says it as if they just had the fucking idea, and it's the most original fucking idea in the world, and they're fucking super smart for coming up with it, and oh my god, could you imagine that game? Like, at this point, it's so boring and derivative. I don't give a shit, and the game isn't even doesn't even exist yet. Like, why wouldn't they do something cool? Like, why wouldn't they try to, like... come in from, like, a different angle. Why wouldn't they try to be like, oh, yeah, Norse mythology is pretty cool. But, like, I mean, Thor is, like, kind of a big movie character right now. Like, it's getting a little... Like,
what if he has to fight it's the getting, Avengers?
What if he had to fight, like, the Aztec pantheon? Or, like just some really weird, like, Eastern religion or, like
weird
just
Eastern
different.
Religion, like those Hindu
yeah,
people.
Yeah, like those weird like people Vishnu, on the other side of the world.
Just beat Vishnu to death yeah, with their mini
yeah,
arms.
Why not?
Yeah. What if
but
this
why
next,
is it, like, what does it matter?
What if this next
like,
game
why does it have to be Norse gods?
What if this next game isn't even, like, targeted at one specific mythology and he's actually just on a war to take out all religions?
It's like everything.
Yeah,
yeah that's
yeah,
kind of what
that?
It is. I mean, why Kratos, though? No one
what
likes
if, what if, like, Kratos. The last of the Greek gods, like, picked up the phone and called the Norse gods and was like, hey, guys, hell's a-coming. And then, boom, God of War 4.
Yeah. The only reason he's not going to kill Jesus is because, like, I think Christianity is probably a boring religion when it comes to, like, epic video games, you know? There's not, like,
there was
crazy
that one Bible
giant
game that
gods
came
in
out.
The sky. Yeah.
Yeah, Kratos
safe from
Kratos. Kratos is swimming, and he just punches a hole in the side of the ark, and it sinks.
They should have had him go from Greek gods to Roman gods, and it would have been just basically the
basically
same.
Basically the same. Yeah.
What
yeah,
I want to
like,
know is,
but
what,
like he still keeps getting them confused for like the Greek.
What I want to know is
punching
in,
a hole in Noah's
what
ark.
What in God's name? Like what kind of
maybe
motivation?
Maybe if he goes through Noah's ark and kill at least one of
he
each.
He finds
animal.
That guy Job and just punches the shit out.
What in God's name could Kratos' motivation be for taking out anything other than Greek mythology?
Is it Kratos?
Well, I mean, like, the concept art makes it look like
does
Kratos.
Does that make any sense chronologically?
No. Like, none of it does. Like, if this doesn't
he
feature...
He fucked the shit out of Eve in the Garden of Eden.
Like,
that's what
like,
he does.
I am all for New God of...
She chokes out Adam with the snake.
I am all for a New God of War... featuring like a new mythology, but I am gonna be sorely disappointed if it actually features Kratos and not an original character.
I think his
motivation was taking out the Greek gods for fucking murdering his family. Yeah. What reason does he have to just go start murdering other gods?
Maybe one of them gave him like a parking ticket.
Is it just like...
What if we just have a taste for blood and it's just like, I'm just not gonna stop here.
But that's the thing. Like, the thing is, if you believe in Norse gods, why would they not be there in those other games? Does he like hop on a plane and go to a place and they just live in a different place? Because they're gods. They're everywhere.
Yeah, they live in a different part of the world. Yeah. They're the gods of that country.
Like, I move on.
It should be Goddess of War. It should be a lady.
Like, who cares?
Ooh, that'd
who
be
cares?
Good.
I would play that.
Would she fuck dudes, though?
Oh, I mean, hopefully women.
Did God of War...
God damn, you were this close to being... You know, never mind. No.
Because you fuck a lot of ladies as
let's
a
move
creator.
On. Let's
you gotta get those button taps right.
Bro. Make that nightstand jump.
Hey, Crispy.
Hey.
How about that Mass Effect footage?
Thing. So apparently an artist, a former artist who worked at BioWare.
Artiste.
I'm not really sure what, I think they were an effects artist or
Doesn't matter.
Computer person or something like that.
They had a job.
Janitor.
Worked at BioWare and submitted a demo reel that... I don't remember the roundabout way this person's demo reel found its way onto YouTube. That demo reel has a lot of footage that is of a new Mass Effect game now known as Mass Effect Andromeda. It's probably important to note that this footage is probably pretty like
early,
like before this maybe even was announced as being Andromeda, like when they were still just like tooling around with new mechanics for these games. But that's why you see down in the bottom left corner, it's got like credits like created pollen plumes, because that's what this person actually did in the video.
Oh, look at those pollen plumes. They look really nice.
I know. Let's hire this guy.
This looks kind of cool. I mean, it looks like a Mass Effect game.
Jetpacks. This is what matters.
Yeah. That is what matters.
Real exploration.
This is the new thing. It looks like the characters might have jetpacks, and it also kind of looked like they were roaming around in like an open planet environment a la Mass Effect 1, which... never really came back.
Dragon Age Inquisition.
Yeah. Well, Dragon Age Inquisition, yeah. But in the Mass Effect series, there was never really that sense of
I'm hoping
of
for more Dragon Age Inquisition environments than I am Mass Effect 1 environments.
Well,
like,
it's well, been a
sure,
long time.
But you're talking about like almost a decade worth
yeah.
of
yeah, for sure.
Improvement. But this is exciting because this is like actual...
Is that Rex or is that just another Krogan?
That's just a Krogan racist.
Yeah, there's no Rex on this game,
But apparently another thing, I don't know where people were getting this because I don't think it's really represented in this footage here, but a big rumor now is that your character doesn't have to be human. Like, you can actually pick different races.
That's cool.
Mm-hmm. Which is really cool. A lot of people were a little nervous about that fact. I think that's probably one of the top items on, like, Mass Effect fans' like want list from a new game is being able to play as a Salarian or a Asari or a Krogan or something like that. Because it would make sense, too, because the whole idea is that...
Chris Davis says he wants to be a Volva.
Volva.
A Volus. Wait, are Voluses are the ones that are like really small?
No, they're little the guys in the suits.
Oh, what were the
pudgy dudes.
Elcors.
Yeah, Elcors. Yeah. I want to be an Elcor.
Jubilant greeting. Hello. I'm so glad to see you. But,
I want to be a Hanar.
That would be really cool. Yeah, the Hanar. Oh, my God.
Dude,
awesome. I wonder what sci-fi wants to be.
You can't touch guns, like you don't do anything.
I think we all know what sci-fi wants to be. I think my body is ready for a new Mass Effect.
Yeah.
But that got delayed.
I'm ready for a good Mass Effect.
Well, they got
delayed. Jetpacks and
they
shit.
They got delayed, but that's okay.
It's been delayed to 2017. You know what?
Let's not even think about new Mass Effect yet. Because
who cares, though?
Wow.
Because this 2016 is also fucking already insane.
Yeah. I
want this game.
I feel like if they said, Mass Effect's coming out in 6 months, I would be like really disappointed by that.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, let's be
honest. You'd be disappointed.
I mean, well, like...
I mean, Final Fantasy XV is now coming out in 6 months, 7 months.
Yeah, I feel like Dragon Age Inquisition didn't have enough time in the oven. Like...
Yeah.
Like, this... Like, if they want to take another year and give me, like, a good game that I'm not going to walk away from feeling disappointed, I've got plenty of stuff to play in the meantime.
Yep.
That's fine with me.
Faux show.
Yeah.
I think what we really have to worry about
those pollen blooms, though.
There's enough
plumes.
Talent at BioWare to still make
those pollen
a game
plumes.
That we really love.
Mm-hmm. Mm, yeah, that's...
Can pollen my
plumes.
Oh,
there's plenty of
day.
Talented folks. I'm sure it'll be cool. All right. I think it's time to move on. We should probably answer a few patron questions and wrap up, right?
No. Sure. Yeah, let's do it.
I mean... Patron questions are a part of the community.
God, you're making me nervous,
Nolan. It's a community.
Well, you're just like patron questions. It's not patron questions. It's community.
You scared the shit out of me. You're looking at me like, we didn't get patron questions.
We got a lot of patron questions.
I know.
But first of all, I would like to talk about the new patrons that we got.
We got a few this week.
Holy shit.
We got a few. I know.
We got two.
Oh, that's a couple.
And for some reason, my doc's not showing them.
If you want to move on, I'll pull up the list. If you want to move on to
one
the other
of them
stuff.
Was.
Don't worry, I'll get it.
Yeah, I already forgot his name. I'm sorry. I wrote them down earlier, but I just forgot the names.
To the other thing, and I'll bring up the list.
So, it's April now. Shut the fuck up, Chris Davis. Shut your goddamn whore mouth. It's April.
What just happened?
Which means it's time for a new supporter of the month.
It is.
We did choose someone. They have been reached out to.
and have not responded yet.
Haven't gotten a response yet. That supporter is Scott Ling.
Scott Ling.
It's the Twitch username. That's all the information Scott we Ling. Have because it is a subscriber on Twitch.
Scott Ling, are you here?
I don't know if I've ever seen Scott Ling.
I have our new patrons.
Okay, there's two of them.
Is it really just two?
I'm 99% sure.
There's one from okay, because I'm sure that Piosh pledged.
Piosh was a repledge, Nick.
Yeah, he's a repledge. Okay, okay.
So we've mentioned him before. He doesn't deserve to be mentioned again.
Well, he's already been mentioned. Tyler H.
Tyler H.
Thank you, Tyler H. And then Red Swallow.
Red Swallow. That was Red Swallow.
Thank you for supporting us on Patreon.
Thanks, guys. We appreciate it. So anyway, it is worth noting our current support or previous support of the month, March.
Mm-hmm.
Prince of the Universe.
Prince of the Universe.
Who his
game.
His patron name was like Ryan Does Art.
Yeah. I think.
Oh yeah.
Unbelievable.
When I picked the new supporter because I do random number generators, he got picked again.
What the fuck?
So obviously he doesn't get to be supporter of the month again.
Yeah.
So I redid.
Not
it.
Happening.
And yeah, Scott.
We got to play more of that game that doesn't save.
But yeah, Brad, you did play a little bit of Malditas Castilia.
It's cool.
Yeah, you like it?
It's cool. I just wish I could
save your progress and continue again. Yeah, that's the only downside of that. But yeah, so it's time for some questions from our patrons, our patronage. First one this week from Ryan Does Art. Recently, I've seen a few gaming sites adopt the scoreless review in favor of a yes, no, maybe, or just a small summary blurb about what they did or did not like about the game. How do you feel about this change, and would you like or dislike if every gaming site adapted this style?
You know, I like reviews without scores because I would probably read a lot more of them if I didn't know there was just a score I could scroll down to. I mean, that's the default. The thing is, I don't know if I'd want all.
So it's tough because then how do you do an aggregate reviewing system?
That's the only reason I think people even use
how
scores
can some,
anymore.
Yeah, no, and that is. How can something like Metacritic, unless everyone adopted it and then Metacritic became almost like a Rotten Tomatoes type of scoring system where they have to
now that you think about it, that is the answer.
That would be what they'd have to do.
They would just have to change.
But it's not that, you know, one site could do it. Everyone would have to do it. And that
yeah,
way,
but they do it based on percentage of
yes or
no.
Yeah,
but there's also a numerical score, like a 7.2 or an 8.5 on Rotten Tomatoes.
But who pays attention to this?
I do sometimes.
Damn it!
Because sometimes you'll see a game or a movie that has a high percentage, but it's a very low score, which means a lot of people just liked it.
Yeah. Because in that regard, yeah, you can take, if we switch to this style, yeah, you can take the percentage as it's I should play it, but do you actually want to play it? Then when you look at that score, it's like, oh, you know, someone can dislike a movie, like on like thing in terms of Rotten Tomatoes, but you should still watch it. So they give it, you know, the thumbs up.
Yeah.
It wasn't the best, but still watch it. But maybe if they were giving a review, they would have given it like a 60.
Yeah.
Like still worth watching, but it's a 60. So then if you were to aggregate all of those reviews, even though it's maybe like an 85, yeah, the score might actually be like 60. So yeah, there is a give and take in terms of you really should read the review. I mean, I know some sites, I don't read a whole lot of reviews. I'll look at stuff like Metacritic just to get like an overall kind of.
I read less of them nowadays, predominantly because we talk about them.
Yeah.
And I prefer to go into our own discussions without thinking too much about what other people thought about the game.
Mm-hmm.
Not that I'm not interested in what other people have to say about it. It's just, you know, if I do read a review, a lot of times I wait until after I've played a little bit myself and talked about it, and then I go and read it.
Yeah. But yeah, so I guess I understand, but it's tough because it's one of those things where, yeah, a lot of the times I think one of the reasons they're switching away from that is because, yeah, people would just scroll to the bottom, look at the final score and be like, all right, cool, thanks.
Yeah.
And that was the same thing, I think, Kotaku for a while. I don't know if they still do this. They switched to like a... not a review, but they can't like a yes or no.
Yeah.
And this is why.
I kind actually, of type honestly, deal. I prefer that format because it gets straight to the point. Recommended or not, without getting bogged down like.
I like a score, and I'll explain why. It's because I look at, I go to Game Rankings, and I see all these Dark Souls reviews, and I see that Phil Cole or Polygon gave Dark Souls 3 a 7.
Yeah.
Now I'm going to go read that review because I want to find out why he gave it a 7. Why? But I would have, I may have not clicked that review if I didn't see that 7 next to his
yeah
review, and I read it and I found out, okay, well, this is what he didn't like about Dark Souls 3. Hey, it's kind of linear.
Yeah, but Nolan was mentioning, like with Kotaku's more recent reviews have been like, they give you, you score at the bottom, it just says, like, yes, and it's, like, a green box, and it shows, like, and it's, like, a bolted list of boom, 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 but then it also has a list of things that they didn't like about the game.
Pros and cons.
Yeah, it has
positives and negatives.
Yeah, but ultimately it ends in a recommendation, whether you should buy it or not, or rent it, or whatever. Like, I kind of like those kind of reviews. But, you know, honestly, I think it's just a personal preference thing. Everyone's going to have their own preference, and I don't think there's ever going to be a time when every single site switches
to an extent, I think that style is easier. Because I don't write a whole lot of reviews. I did in the past more.
Mm-hmm.
And it's hard, you know, to come up with a, like, what is this, an 8.5? Is this, like, you know, exactly what you give? It can be difficult to give it an actual number score.
Well, a lot of times it's just easier to say, this is what I like, this is what I didn't
like. Yeah, exactly. And I think that's easier for reviewers to be like, yes, you should play it. This is why it's good. This is why some things you might not like about it. There.
Yeah.
I think that's a lot easier than kind of, you know, coming up with like a number that you might end up regretting. Like later on, you might be like, maybe I shouldn't have given it that. Maybe I should have given it this.
Yeah.
Whereas later on, you're not going to change your mind whether you would recommend it to someone.
Yeah. I mean,
all right.
Next question.
A lot of time on that one. Thanks. Yeah. Thanks, Ryan Desart. Next question from Piosht.
Piosht.
If you could have a guest on the podcast to talk games with, who would it be?
That's tough.
Like another kind of like
personality
out there? Anybody.
PewDiePie. I'd love to have PewDiePie.
I've actually been listening to the Kind of Funny Games cast. I kind of like Greg Miller. I think he'd be a fun guy to talk to.
He's got too much energy for our podcast.
He does have a lot of energy.
Yeah.
But you know, I think he'd be a really fun guy to talk to.
I'm going with PewDiePie. Because it'll help us skyrocket our podcast to success.
I was going to say Barack Obama.
Even better.
Yeah.
Donald Trump.
No, thank you.
He retweeted something about Mass Effect. I didn't read that story.
Yeah, it was a trailer somebody had cut, like, using audio from Mass Effect. Like Mass Effect 3 trailer.
Fucking EA.
Yeah, but it was all like footage of Donald Trump and like other politicians and stuff. And you should just watch it. It's ridiculous. It's ridiculous.
You know who I like?
What? Who?
Vinny from Giant Bomb. Seems like a
Vinny's pretty
like
chill.
A nice guy to talk to.
Yeah, for sure.
Scarlett Johansson.
Reaching for the stars, Nolan. I like that about you.
Joel McHale.
What?
No.
Nah, I'll pass on Joel McHale.
Yeah, no. Great. No, thank you.
Oh, yeah.
What about you, Crispy? What was that your answer?
Joel McHale.
Joel McHale. Okay. I wasn't sure if you were serious or not.
Nolan North.
Troy Baker. No, now we're just naming.
You're just naming people who work in
Jennifer
games.
Lawrence.
No, but I'm not. I would love to have Nolan North on the podcast.
Oh, sure. Yeah, that would be great.
I would love to touch Nolan North.
We have what so much in common.
We have half of our names in
I will say I ended up watching like that entire thing where he was talking about his career, Nolan North. He did like some panel at some
small.
It was like an hour long talk where he was just sitting there leaning up against the table talking to a group of people, and I was like, he looks like a really easy guy to talk to.
Definitely. And we have the same name.
And that.
That'd be cool.
There's not a lot of Nolans out there.
There's not. Most Nolans out there, Nolan's their last name.
Scarecrow would like to have us to have Mila Kunis on
the
show.
I'd be cool with that. I like Mila Kunis.
I think we'd all be okay with that. All right, let's move on. All
right, next question from Mr. Green Toast.
Jessica Alba loves Dark Souls.
What?
Mr. Green Toast. Do you have any comments or thoughts over the Overwatch debacle?
Yeah. Oh, with the butt pose?
Where all the devs removed a victory pose for the female character due to it being too sexy. If you already talked about the issue, but we didn't. What are your personal favorite video game butts?
Two things. One, when the fuck has this industry been... cared that much about being too sexy? I'm pretty sure everything in the, like, so much
that's
shit in this
not,
industry is over sexualized.
That's not what happened, but okay.
I mean, it's okay. All I know is
what that, happened. That's was, all. That's what that's happened. Was somebody on the Overwatch forums posted an posted a thing about how they thought the pose didn't fit with the character, and
Blizzard, I don't really know much about Overwatch.
Blizzard read it, took it into consideration, said, "Hey, you know what? You're right. We're gonna change it." And then everyone said censorship, and it got like a little fucking out of control. And then people on both sides were being assholes to each other about a butt pose, and then they changed it to that. Which
wait, that's what they changed it to?
That's what they changed it to.
That seems more sexualized than the original.
I actually like the second one better.
That is, I think the second one's a little better because it's a little bit more of like kind of a fun like pinup pose instead of it just being like, hey, here's my asshole.
Yeah.
Like,
well, she's not bent over. You won't be able to see her asshole.
But I mean look how the butt is more accentuated on the second one than the first one.
As long as I got a place to stick my face.
So the questions become: is it censorship because Blizzard changed it, or is it censorship because people are mad that Blizzard changed it when it's their game and they have a right to change or not change?
Yeah,
whatever
who
they
cares?
Want.
Sure.
Like, who
creators
cares?
Of these games
like,
do whatever yeah. they want.
I was just gonna say,
best butts in video.
As a fan of butts,
I think
it seems like a little.
I think the best butts in video games are the butts in Dark Souls 3 when you're wearing a robe.
Oh, I saw that.
Have you seen that?
The butt glitch.
If you wear a robe,
is that
going to
survive 1.0?
I don't know. We'll see.
I hope so.
We'll see. Let's see the butts.
Best. I mean,
you'd have to say Meryl.
My personal favorite.
Bayonetta?
No, Meryl, because you—that's how you recognize. You recognize that ass.
Oh, right, because of a butt.
Yeah.
That ass.
That ass, actually.
I'm pretty sure that's what Snake said.
You know who's got nice? That ass. You know who's got a nice tail? Spyro.
Raiden.
Rainbow Mika. Death by butt.
There is, I think I brought it up before, but in Catherine, you do get to romp around on Catherine's with a C's butt.
Yes, that's
you
true.
Do?
You do. You do. My personal favorite video game butt has always been Miranda. From Mass Effect.
Mm. No, right. Dude, Samus's butt. But not like Zero Suit Samus, like fully armored Samus.
Rainbow Mika and her partner literally sandwich your head between their butt cheeks.
Yeah, that is true. They
and,
do.
They're, and they're super.
I mean, if we're talking about Street Fighter butts, though, like...
That one girl from Senran
right?
Kagura?
Cammy's got a nice butt.
Cammy, right? She's,
Laura's
that girl
got
is
a
all
nice butt.
Oh, and so is Chun-Li.
Chun-Li. Yeah. Oh, she's got all kinds of business with those thighs.
All right, moving on. Next question.
Do we have to move on?
From Samin. When talking about video games, developers, publishers, and the industry as a whole, it seems like the only prevalent markets are Japan and the West, North America and Europe. What are y'all thoughts about other markets in the world, like South America, Africa, the Middle East, and Southeast Asia? Will there ever be a time when one of these markets becomes global and has major influence on the industry? I think so. A lot of South American developers are popping up as of lately.
A lot of developers are popping up, but the like the consumer base in South America is not good at all because
I remember
when we were working at GameStop together. I remember a customer came in and they were from Brazil, I believe it was.
Yeah.
And they actually had like they lived in a town that had a Microsoft manufacturing plant where they made Xboxes. Like right there in their town. But Xboxes were way too expensive for anybody to own. And I mean that is as much a product of Brazilian economy as anything, which Brazilian economy has been completely fucked up. Like they had to invent a new currency like 20 years ago or something.
Yeah.
Just to not fall prey to explosive inflation.
Yeah.
So these people when they were coming to America, they were buying like 2 and 3 and 4 Xboxes at a time just because they were relatively reasonably priced here compared to like I think he had said something like the conversion was something like $1,000 for a 360.
Jesus.
Down there. So I think
who do they think they are?
I think the fact that there is a wide development community popping up in those areas is really nice, but a lot of stuff is going to have to change before, like, a consumer base.
Yeah, I mean, a lot of that consumer base is purely going to be...
Is becoming, like, a global decider.
It's all kind of dependent upon the state of the economy and whatnot. I mean...
And I think, with this economy.
And I think that's going to be a situation
yeah,
where...
Not that we're, like, the...
we're talking about console games. I think PC gaming is definitely going to take off in those countries a lot quicker than console gaming, just because PCs are a lot easier to come by. Now, in that regard, yeah, there still is, the tax and the increased prices, which is why a lot of people do the Steam cracks down on, you know, like Australian Steam VPN is much more expensive, and people will VPN into it to make it look like they're from a different country so they can pay less. And so that whole situation does definitely suck. But
if you look at like the what is actually prominent gaming wise in other countries and regions, is a lot of it is centered around just different facets of the industry in general, like competitive pro gaming and things like that. And you know, I just feel like the market and the interest in it is fueled by something entirely different in a lot of places.
All right, we need to wrap
before. Let's do one more question, then wrap up.
Can we do two more so I can do one and then find a good one? Because we have a lot more. We have 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. We have a lot more questions.
God damn.
And I haven't looked through for the best
one. We
had
a lot of games to talk about this week.
All right, well, let me do Red Swallows because he's a recent patron.
Okay.
If you could do one thing in a video game industry, regardless of physical limitations, what would example, I'd create a strategy game with the level of complexity of Paradox's games. Heart of Iron, Europa Universalis?
Oh, Europa Universalis?
Yeah. The real-time battles like Kingdom Under Fire or the Total War series with the options to play battles as yourself like Mountain Blade. So if you just like one thing in the video game industry that
I would help Nintendo make better decisions.
I'd like to be a kind of like a systems designer or whatever on like a RPG or a tactics game or something. That'd be cool.
Yeah, if we're talking about like jobs in the industry that we'd like to have, I always thought it'd be neat to be like a scenario writer, you know, kind of more like writing end of it. I don't want to build shit.
Yeah.
Computers suck, you know. But like scenario writing would be cool.
I'd want to be an advisor,
voice actor.
I would want to be the new CEO of Konami.
Yeah.
I'd do all the southern voices,
dude. But
should be a voice actor, hands down.
It would be like one of those dark political dramas where you want to become the CEO of Konami,
and you can rename it Konami.
You finally get there. You're the CEO, and you're like, I'm gonna turn this company around. We're gonna be making good Castlevania games and good fucking Metal Gear Solid, and we're gonna make Silent Hills and all that stuff. You finally get into the inner circle, the upper echelons of Konami, and then they let you in on the secret, and you're like, oh wait,
what was
no.
the question? Do we miss
we have
the
to maintain the status quo.
Oh, God.
Did we miss the point of the question?
You keep pushing out Castlevania pachinko machines. I think we answered it. let's keep going.
The question was, if you could do one thing in the video game industry, regardless of physical limitations, what would it be? Like he was saying, creating a strategy game with levels of complexity. Essentially, if you could change a game, if you could create a game, that's something that the industry currently would not create because of limitations, what would you do? One thing I've always wanted to do or have is a Pokemon game that's like open world, that's like realistic.
A Pokemon game using the Final Fantasy 15 engine.
Yeah, something like that. Like where
or
you actually run around.
Just a console based Pokemon game. Yeah.
Well, they've had those. Pokemon XD on the GameCube.
No, but like actual Pokemon.
Yeah.
Like a 2 version.
And the problem is, I don't think that's ever going to come out, at least in the time where I'm not even interested in Pokemon anymore. What was the last one I played? And I started playing it.
Maybe you would be if they would make...
I was like, why the fuck am I playing this? It's the same goddamn shit.
Maybe you would, though, if it wasn't the same goddamn shit. If I could do anything regardless of limitations, fuck it. I would make Silent Hills.
Wait, I got one.
I would make it.
I got one. Follow me here for a second. This is going to sound a little crazy, but imagine a Hitman game that is like networked to a bunch of other different games that aren't Hitman. And when you're playing this Hitman game, your targets are other people playing different characters in different games, and you're assassinating those characters while they're playing. So like, what if someone's playing Madden?
That makes
Madden?
No sense, but I love
playing,
it.
What if someone's playing Madden and they're like, you know, they're playing like Peyton Manning or something, and they're throwing
like
the football,
Boy
and
Scout.
you're playing Hitman, and your job is like, all right, you got to kill this fucking football player, so you're in the stadium, like, setting up an assassination while this guy's just playing Madden, has no idea what's going on, and then right in the middle of the fucking game, like,
a shark comes out of nowhere.
I would want a Hitman game that's multiplayer. Where someone plays the target and someone else is hit. It's almost like Spy Party, where when you're the target, you have tasks that you have to complete, and you have to like on the lookout for Hitman, and you're trying to avoid. I think that would be interesting.
You have to banana bread.
What is that? What the fuck is that bread?
We've all wanted that for years.
Well, that's what I'm saying. If you had unlimited resources and we weren't limited by anything,
I would remake every game ever.
All right, final question for the evening. Final question from Zerby.
Zerba. No, that one's not sticking.
Zerba. He was in chat the other day. I could not stop saying it.
If you could time travel, if you could travel back in time and retain only the knowledge you have of gaming, would you do anything to alter the industry? If so, what would you do? Buy Nintendo stock right before the Wii
came
out. That
doesn't change. That just changes your fucking bank account. It doesn't change the industry.
No, but technically that's financial information.
I wouldn't
remember how well it
did. I would shout from the rooftops that don't buy into this Kinect shit.
You know what I would do? Nothing, because trying to change the timeline is crazy. You're going to destroy the universe.
Oh. Or that.
You alter that's what the I industry.
I would sabotage that one E3 press conference with the bottom of an avatar shoe or whatever.
You know what you
would
need to do? You'd have to go back in time to like the founding of like Babbage's
Funkoland
Electronics Boutique, and you'd have to squash that, nip it in the bud. Don't let there be like a dedicated video game retailer like that. Because that's why we have pre-orders. That's why we have the pre-owned market. Like, that's why, like, I know it sucks. Video games might still be expensive.
A lot
of problems that we complain about nowadays are resulting from companies like GameStop existing and being such a monolithic presence in the industry.
Has GameStop taken a hit since this new Amazon policy on pre-orders? Because I feel like that is the thing that people have been wanting for pre-orders forever.
The thing is, Amazon used to do this.
Well, they should keep doing it, because I will never pre-order a game.
What Amazon used to do, which was a better idea, was when you pre-ordered a game, they would give you a discount off your next pre-order. So it would keep
this
you...
I guess that's true.
It would keep you... The discount comes in the next time you pre-order a game.
Yeah,
and so true. It would literally... This, you just fucking get 20% off straight up. Yeah. Yo. But that would force you to keep doing it. But, I mean, yeah, there's nothing...
Yeah. Anyway. That's true. Anyways... Thank you so much for your questions. We're sorry if we didn't get to all of them. I know we didn't.
Yeah, there's way too many games we talked about today.
To talk about this week, but we'll open up the post again over the weekend, so you can get more your questions in for next week. If you want to ask the same question again, by all means.
Yeah, definitely.
If we didn't get around to it, so now we're gonna wrap up the show. Now is a 4-player minute, though.
What?
So we're gonna try something a little new, and this is. So we've been playing Geek Out a little bit, but we've been trying to find a better format for it.
For Geek Out.
So what we're going to do is we're going to modify it a little bit. We're going to pick a category, and each of us are going to have 10 seconds to name one of those things in the category, and we're going to keep going until we're all out.
Let's do five seconds.
Wait, are we opening this up to all categories, or are we still only doing video game stuff?
Video games theme stuff.
You sure?
Well, let's do Star Trek characters. That'd be fun for us all.
I mean, that round would just end really quickly and we'd move on to something else.
No, Crispy, I'm putting my foot down. Video games. So, we're going to see how this first round goes. I would say... Oh, Brett, watch out, your mic is falling. What are you doing?
Geez. It does that every time he moves it slightly.
All right, Crispy, you ready? You have a category ready to go? I would say if people in chat have ideas for categories that we could do...
Tweet them at me.
Tweet them at Crispy, at Inspector Chris.
Inspector Chris with a K.
K-R-I-S. So basically you're going to pick a video game theme category. We're going to go around. We're each going to name one. And so once we can't name one off that list, we're out. And then we're going to keep going.
Let's do it.
10 seconds. 10 seconds is the limit per category, per name. Okay?
All right.
All right, we'll start with Nolan, who is on my left. Arcade-style racing video games.
Pole position.
Wipeout.
Cruising USA.
Burnout.
Need for Speed.
Motorstorm.
Daytona. Wait, no. Fuck.
Nick's out.
I'm out.
Cruising USA.
Cruising the world!
USA!
No! You are out, Crispy.
Star Wars pod racing.
What?
No,
that's not what that's called.
Pod racer.
That's not what it's called.
What is it called?
You're out.
That's what it's called.
I don't name the game.
It's called Star Wars Racer. And then Star Wars Racer Revenge.
Whatever.
Hydro Thunder.
I think,
and then I'm out afterwards because I can't name anything.
Look at
else.
That. Brad won. Brad won.
There you go.
All right, next one. I like this better. Okay, this
Brad,
is better.
Brad, you're gonna start us off. Okay. First person shooters that take place during World War II.
Brothers in Arms, Road to Hill 30.
Call of Duty 2.
Call of Duty.
What?
Are we doing that? Are we doing that?
We're doing individual games. Okay. I feel like if we're doing it this way.
All right.
Sniper Elite.
Medal of Honor.
Brothers in Arms.
I did Road to Hill 30.
The reason why we didn't do it before the other way was because it was one person having to name like 10 games.
Wait.
And it's kind of a cop out if they're naming five games from the same series. But if we're all pulling from the same pool, and let's say his is Brother in Arms, Hell's Highway, or whatever.
Here's a question.
But you say it before him, he doesn't get to say
we're
that.
We're still
now.
Going. We're still going. Is this one? Resistance? Was that? Didn't that take place?
That took place after World War II, didn't it? Or did it take place before World War II? World War II didn't happen in Resistance.
All right, let's keep going.
Nick's out.
Fuck, I'm out.
Okay.
It was a good attempt, though, right?
Okay, fine. Call of Duty World at War.
This sucks. This is dumb.
I got nothing.
Medal of Honor Frontline.
Medal of Honor Airborne.
Oh!
Medal of Honor 2.
Call of Duty 3.
This is dumb.
Okay, do you got another one?
Oh, Medal of Honor 2 is not a game.
Medal of Honor Underground. Sorry, I forgot.
This is not Need for Speed.
No, that is the name of... That's the subtitle for Medal of Honor 2.
Really?
Yes.
Oh, man. I didn't even know that.
Don't look at chat.
I just looked at chat and saw one that I forgot.
Oh, sorry. What do we... Call of Duty, the Big Red One.
Okay. Nick didn't say it, so Brother in Arms, Hell's Highway.
Fuck.
Call of Duty, Finest Hours.
Brother in Arms.
This is stupid. No, that's Road to Hill 30. You're out.
No, it's not.
Yes, it is.
It's called Road to Hill 30.
Yes, that's the first one.
Okay, fine. I'm out.
Oh, man. Brad wins two in a row.
Is it still stupid, Brad?
Yes.
It's not stupid.
No one said Wolfenstein.
No one said Wolfenstein.
Oh, God. No one said Metal.
I don't fucking play first-person shooters.
No, Allied Assault. I forgot that was one.
Ever.
Okay. Whatever.
Okay, oh, Nick.
God. Yes.
Nintendo franchises.
Oh, my God.
Did we do this one, though?
Okay. We did that one.
Okay. Nick, that one's...
I nailed that one.
Two games that take place on Mars.
Red Faction Guerrilla.
Red Faction Army.
Oh, my God.
Red Faction?
Red Faction 2.
Shit!
Where did we go from here?
Oh, God!
No!
No, I got one. No. I got one. If Nick can't go, if Griffin can't go, I got
one. Why can't I go?
Yeah.
Wait,
you said, who said Red Faction 2?
Brad. Red Faction Brad's 2 out. Has levels on Mars.
Okay. Nick.
I'm out.
Okay.
I can't.
Okay.
out.
Was there a Prometheus tie-in game?
No.
What?
Out. Prometheus? And why would that even take place on Mars?
That was on Mars, wasn't it?
Mars Warlogs.
I don't. That
oh, is that really on Mars?
I guess sure, it is. Yeah.
Mars War.
Total Recall.
There's not a game.
Yeah, there is.
Is there?
Yes, on For the what? NES.
Oh, boo.
Oh, shit. Doom 3.
Doom 3.
Doom 3.
You were already out.
No, it was back to me.
Doom.
Oh, that's right. I said Prometheus.
Yeah.
Jesus, wait, who's even out anymore?
You two are out. Me and Brad are tending.
We need to cut multiple series. We have to, right? It's so corny.
That is.
What?
Because at one point you can kind of go on fucking
forever.
Dude,
fuck you guys. That was hilarious. I don't care what you're talking about. I don't even care. Are we out? Is that it? Wait, who won that round? No one's talking anymore.
Me and Nolan tied. Yeah. I don't know whose turn it is, and that makes this too hard. Let's just do the next one.
Last one. Last one of the night.
Crispy start.
These suck.
These suck. I don't doubt that they suck.
We did that one. No.
Well, take a question from chat.
Okay. God damn it.
Okay. Fictional towns in video games.
Oh yeah. Okay.
Oh God, we did this one.
Yeah, but we haven't done it in this format.
Have we done this?
Who starts? You Crispy. Start.
Crispy. I'll start. Xanarkin.
Blam Gardens.
Calm with a K.
Traverse Town.
Arkham City.
Liberty City.
Midgar.
I'm trying to.
We allowed to I'm say out. From the same. I mean, it's fictional towns. Yeah.
Oh yeah. San Andreas.
Grand Soren.
I don't know why I fucked that up.
Junon.
Vice City.
Pewter town.
No.
Pewter City.
Yeah, there we go.
Nibelheim.
God damn it, Brad. Every game in every city in Final Fantasy VII.
Fucking Viridian City.
Yeah, that's what I said. This is going to be ridiculous because you can just start naming Pokemon towns. Cerulean City.
How many Pokemon towns?
Did you go? Yeah. Oh, this is dumb.
Yeah. We can't. I think.
Cosmo Canyon.
God damn it. Okay. This is going to keep going.
And Orlando.
This is dumb. This is real dumb.
Yeah, this one we could technically go on.
We could go on forever really in a long time.
Look, nothing has
Costa
changed.
Costa del Sol.
Yeah. Nothing has changed.
Well, I think it's just, that one is such a broad. Condor. That one is such a broad category.
You can stop naming them now.
Yeah,
the ancient city.
Stop it! Just stop naming them, Brad.
I'm sure we can find ones in here that would fit.
I'm honestly curious to see what people if people could suggest some cool topics.
Kokori Village.
Yeah, that's how I was gonna start doing Zelda ones too.
Yeah, this is too many.
Okay, fine.
Games with a skateboarding theme's horrible.
Why not just
Castlevania City?
Fucking female protagonist.
This one. Games in which a dinosaur appears. Did we already do that one?
I think we did that one. I don't think so.
I remember naming like Dino Crisis.
Did,
stuff like that.
Oh, I got a good one.
Is Yoshi a dinosaur?
I got a good one.
All right.
And I will start us off. Fictional games. Triple Triad.
Wait, fictional
like
games?
Like in-universe games. Like games that people in this universe, like fictional games that were made up specifically as part of a story.
Okay, that is pretty
Blitzball.
So stupid. Chocobo Racing.
Okay.
Tetramaster.
Gwent.
Oh! Yeah! God damn it. I think you're out.
Hey, it's not supposed to interrupt me.
No, I'm out. Brad.
The dice game from Suikoden.
What's it called?
It's the dice game.
Okay.
You roll dice on a bowl.
That's fucking weird, but okay.
I'm out.
Quidditch.
What?
That's fucking bullshit.
That is not bullshit. There is an entire game based around
but
Quidditch.
But it's based on a book.
But it's supposed to be...
It's a fictional game!
Wait, so we're not doing video games?
We are. That was a video game. It just says fictional games. It says fictional games. It's a fictional game.
All right,
fine. Rocket League Remote Control Car Soccer. Fictional?
Fine. The Leandri Tournament from Unreal Tournament.
Fucking Blitz Ball. I mean, like...
That already got said! You're out! You're out.
I mean, like, Blitz Football.
Yeah, he meant football, like the Blitz game. Football.
It's fictional?
No, Blood Bowl.
Blood Bowl's real.
No, it's not!
What Blood Bowl is real? What
the NBA Street.
Oh, that's not... No, you're just... That's not a thing now. That's Brad, not a fictional game.
I think Brad's out.
Brad's out.
Griff Ball.
No! Battle Gears from Xenogears.
You were already out.
Putting the foot down. Crispy won that
you
round.
You were already.
Crispy won that round.
All right.
I don't like that Crispy's picking these categories.
Yeah,
though.
You were picking them. No. Oh my God. Okay, fine. Go ahead.
Right, pick it up. No, we're done.
No,
we're
we
done.
Need to stop.
The podcast is over.
It's late.
This is the end. This is the end. All right. All right, guys. We're done.
Game characters named Bonnie. Go.
Red Dead.
Fuck yourself.
Which one?
Redemption.
All right.
Can you open chat, please?
That's the end of our show tonight, guys. I know we had a lot of games to talk about, so we didn't get to a lot of viewer questions this week. We'll get to more next week. Next week, we should be able to talk at length about Quantum Break. I'm hoping Crispy plays some Hyper Light Drifter, maybe?
Yeah, I've only played like an hour of it.
I really wanted to ask you about that, but you haven't played a whole lot yet. So
if I find time for it.
Next week, we should have more new games to talk about. Not nearly as many this week. I would like to remind everybody, of course, you can follow us at 4playernetwork.com. You can also watch us broadcast games every single day over at 4pp.tv. And we record these podcasts every single Tuesday night, 8 p.m. Central Standard Time. Anything else y'all want to add before we wrap up?
The King of Iron Fist tournament from Tekken.
God damn it.
I'm going to take that as a no.
The
Thanks
Twisted
for listening.
Metal tournament.
I love you.
Thank you for listening, everyone. We'll see y'all next week.
Bye.
Peace out.
Bye.